tailgate party in Lincoln, Nebraska, baby.
Yeah!
Hold it!
One week ago, Bo Pelini's Huskers left the tunnel with something to prove, and they did just that. The offense put up points.
Now Gans looking, firing wide open. Swift, he's going to take it to the house.
The defense made plays.
Here comes the pressure. Hiller gets hit as he lets it go. Intercepted Nebraska.
And all was well in Husker Nation. But that was then, and this is now. Today, they're faced with a new opponent and a new challenge in San Jose State. Can the Huskers prove the naysayers wrong again? Find out next on FSN.
Huskers, baby. We're going to go. Here we go. Right now, it's showtime.
The power of red is alive and well in Lincoln, Nebraska on a cool and cloudy Saturday morning, an absolutely perfect day for college football, and the Huskers look to remain perfect themselves as today they face the Spartans of San Jose State. Hello again, everybody. Along with Matt Davidson, I'm Ron Thula. And of course, Matt, last week, Bo Pelini said, I'm going to approach this game like any other game. Now, the players say differently, of course. All in all, very successful first official head coaching job for Bo Pelini.
That's right. Much anticipation all across the Husker Nation. Ever since Tom Osborne hired Bo Pelini last December, everybody pointed to last Saturday. And I think Bo Pelini brought a lot of intensity to this Nebraska football program. And they went out and got himself a 47-24 win versus Western Michigan last week.
Well, you know, Matt, one of the question marks obviously was the defense, but that question was answered. They played outstanding, especially the defensive line. But the one person that caught everybody's attention was linebacker Cody Glenn. He played great.
That's right. And Cody Glenn played running back at Nebraska until this season. Cody Glenn brought a lot to this defense last week, Ron. Most of all, it was intensity. He brought enthusiasm and excitement to this Nebraska defense, a defense that struggled mightily at times in 2007. And maybe more than his 12 tackles, last week Cody Glenn was great in pass coverage. He was able to cover backs out of the backfield and cover tight ends as they got out into pass routes as well. Cody Glenn was tremendous for Nebraska's defense a week ago.
He almost seemed like he had Western Michigan's playbook at one point in the game, but the coaches have stayed on him the entire week saying, you know, yeah, you had a good game, but you made a lot of mistakes. Even Cody Glenn said, I looked at the tape, I wasn't as good as I thought I was. So we look to see some improvement from him today. Now on the offensive side of the ball, obviously this offense picked up where they left off last year, rolling up 480 yards. But I think what stood out to all of us, the play of Joe Gans and his mobility, that's a whole new dimension for this offense.
Right, and for Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator at Nebraska, he knows that. And I'll tell you what, having a mobile quarterback puts a lot of pressure on a defense, and that's the one guy that a defense before the ball is snapped is not accounted for. So Joe Gans, he uses his feet well. He's a better athlete than most people give him credit for. And when he gets out of the pocket, that's where he really makes things happen for Nebraska. He's a pinpoint passer. He's not big in the pocket at about 6 feet tall, but he uses that athleticism and really brings another dimension to the offense. He uses his feet, and once he gets out of the pocket, he gives his wide receivers a chance to work downfield, Ron. And I can tell you as a wide receiver, that gives you a lot of confidence that you never quit on a play. Joe Gans brings that to this offense. That's why he threw for 345 yards a week ago.
He was outstanding. Now let's talk about the other side of the football. 2 years ago, San Jose State had a magical season going to their first bowl game since 1990. Last year, tripped up a little bit at 5-7. This year, head coach Dick Tomey tells us, hey, we've got talent. The problem is, Matt, they've got to find a quarterback and then stick with that person.
Last week against UC Davis, San Jose State went through three quarterbacks, and the third one was Kyle Reed, and he came in and played tremendously. San Jose State was able to pull out a win 13-10 on 2 second-half touchdown passes by Kyle Reed, 14 of 18 and 132 yards. He was tremendous. He's got a strong arm, and he's really athletic, Ron. But this offensive line in front of him is sort of pieced together. They're starting three sophomores today and two juniors. And coming into this season, only four combined starts for this offensive line.
Before we go to the tunnel walk quickly, if you're Nebraska's defense, are you going to try to mix it up now on these guys and smack them in the face from the very first possession?
I think so. Nebraska wants to come out and let San Jose State know from the start that they don't have a chance to come in here to Lincoln and get a win. And on the opposite side for San Jose State, they want to come out and get some momentum right out of the gate. So we'll see what happens to start this game.
Well, San Jose State coach is telling us on Wednesday they've got to be physical in this ball game. They're not sure if they match up. But this is the second of five consecutive home games for the Huskers. They want to put together a win. Now, one of the special traditions here at Nebraska, as all of you Husker fans know, is the tunnel walk. Last week was the first time for a number of players. They told me yesterday it was awesome. It was unbelievable. It was bone-chilling. Let's take you inside the tunnel walk prior to this game with the Spartans of San Jose State. And we are just moments away from the opening kickoff. Game two of the 2008 season. The Huskers and the Spartans straight ahead.
It's war time. It's war time. It's time to go to war. That's what we out here for. That's what we out here for. Saturdays is war time, baby. Let's go.
Another capacity crowd on hand as we take a look at the vital statistics weather-wise. 61 degrees, humidity about 75%, very little wind, and we do have about a 30% chance of showers. As we mentioned, over 80,000 going to be on hand today. The third member of our broadcast team, here's Joel Goldberg with more on that. Joel?
Ron, thanks a lot. San Jose State usually plays their home games in front of a stadium that holds 30,000. Last week, 18,000 showed up for their win against UC Davis. You can fit four times that crowd in here at Memorial Stadium. Wide receiver Jaleel Beachman of San Jose State, a junior, was asked about that this week, about the daunting task of coming to Lincoln, and he said he's not nervous about it at all. He was more nervous about talking to the media at a press conference this week. He said as a kid, he dreamed of coming into a hostile environment and playing against the crowd that was against him. He'll get that opportunity today. Guys, let's go back upstairs to you.
All right, Joel's going to be roaming the sidelines for us today, keeping us apprised of what's going on both sidelines. You take a look at Bo Pelini, and I tell you, we've had 2 weeks in a row now, Matt, we've had a chance to spend some time with him. He has been probably one of the top three open coaches to us, and he owes me a case of Clark Bars for next week, just for the record. And those of you east of the Mississippi understand what I'm talking about on that. Jarrett Strubeck set to kick it away for San Jose State. They won the toss. They have deferred. So Nebraska's high-powered offense will take over to begin the game. Wobbly kick. It's going to be Niles Paul at about the 8-yard line. Has a block. Got some running room. Breaks a tackle. Still on his feet. Knocked out of bounds. They'll mark him at the 35-yard line. Strubeck, the kicker, had to make the stop. His longest, Paul's, was 25 last week. Breaks that today.
A nice wall set up to the right side. There, Ron, Niles Paul using his blocks well. You see the nice patience, a little nifty move to the outside. A parade All-American from right there in Omaha, Nebraska, Niles Paul.
And, of course, the quarterback, Joe Gans, last week, first Nebraska quarterback to throw for 300 yards in four games in a career. Four starts, 19 touchdowns. Marlon Lucky now is behind him. Swift had a great game wide. And they'll give to Lucky. Gets a block from one of his receivers up over the 40 to the 42-yard line. Travis Jones on the stop. And the starting lineups. Obviously, Gans having an outstanding job. He said he threw two interceptions, but, you know, Matt, he said one of those I don't think was my fault. One was just a bad decision. And that's one of the things he wants to work on this year.
Well, the mental errors were probably the number one thing that this coaching staff for Nebraska pointed out all across the board, offensively and defensively, for the Huskers last week.
Swift and Peterson were stacked to the right, and this is going to be Swift. Looks for a block, gets a little one up over the 45. It'll be good for a first down. Iheanacho is the one who comes up and makes the stop. But you look at the numbers of Joe Gans, and spending some time with him yesterday again, I mean, he does have that Chicago attitude, a lot of confidence, but not so much, Matt, that he doesn't look at himself critically and say, I need to improve in this area and this area.
Well, that's right. And I'll tell you what, rarely do you find in sports a guy that's the leader of your football team, that's the most popular guy, that works the hardest on your football team. That's what Bo Pelini has in his quarterback, Joe Gans.
Nate Swift wide to the left. Peterson goes in motion on first and 10 from the 45. Straight drop, a little pressure on the backside, and Gans is going to go down at the 38-yard line. Carl Iheanacho, the junior out of Carson, California, six or five sacks last year. That's his second this year, and Gans is hobbling a little bit.
Mike McNeil was playing on the right side, tight end there, and Iheanacho came around the outside, just got the heel of Joe Gans. You can see he spun around there, and he was hobbling a little bit. We'll see how he reacts, but good protection last week for the most part from Nebraska's offensive line. They're just a breakdown from the right tight end, Mike McNeil.
Mentally, Colt now in the lineup on the near side. Looks like Gans is going to be okay. On second down, we have a whistle. Loss of eight, by the way, on that sack. First sack given up by this Husker offensive line this season.
Dead ball. False start. Offense. Number 61, it's a 5-yard penalty, second down.
Looks like Mike Huff is the one who did it, the senior out of Ralston, Nebraska.
So not the start this offense was looking for. You get the ball at home against a team like San Jose State, and Nebraska's offense wants to go down, put points on the board immediately, and try to shake any confidence that they may have early in this game, and now you find yourself in a second and extremely long here.
Second down, we'll call it 23. Ball's on the 32-yard line. Just about 2 minutes gone by here in the opening quarter. This is what San Jose State wanted to do, move around a lot defensively. Here comes the pressure again. Gans steps up in the pocket. Incomplete pass intended for Holt. Looked at first as though he caught it. He was being guarded by Christopher Owens, one of the two outstanding cornerbacks for San Jose State. Let's take a look at this line for Nebraska. Overall, the coach is pleased with the effort last week. Javario Brooks gets the start for Murtha at right tackle today. Skill position, this will be one of the keys. Can Swift, Peterson, and Holt use their size to their advantage today, because the defensive backs for San Jose State, not very big. Third down and long, third and 23. Last week, they were 5 of 13 in this position. And sees pressure again, steps up, and he's going to be sacked for the second time in their first possession. Adonis Davis with his first sack of the year, the junior out of Linwood, California.
Big defensive tackle right in the middle. Davis with just a bit of a bull rush. And obviously in third and 23, you have to allow your wide receivers to get downfield. Davis was knocked to the ground, gets back up, was able to get Joe Gans to the turf, forcing a punt from Nebraska. Great defensive series there for San Jose State.
Absolutely. No sacks given up last week. Two already here in the opening drive. And Jurevich standing back at his 30-yard line for San Jose State to receive the punt. Titchener's kick, a line drive. Jurevich looks to return it from the 30. Good coverage by this Nebraska punt team. And he is going to be down at about the 42-yard line. Armando Murillo with the snap. And here come the black shirt defense out to the roar of the crowd.
Nebraska's going to need a great performance out of their defense today. And some of these early games in the season, Ron, especially coming off a season that wasn't spectacular defensively in 2007. Nebraska wants to get a lot of confidence for these young guys here on this Nebraska defense, so they want to come out and have a great performance here today.
Well, quickly, San Jose State, led by Kyle Reed, the junior out of Oakland, California, quarterback. Four wide receivers set. He just dumps it off underneath the coverage, up over the 45 to the 48-yard lines, the tight end, Jeff Clark. As we take a look at Kyle Reed, the transfer from Cal, originally out of Oakland, California. He's 6'3", 215. He's a dual-threat guy. Now, he led the team the length of the field with no timeouts. Last week, tossed the game-winning touchdown pass as time was running out. Jeff Tedford told me when he was at Cal, this kid is a stud. He can play.
Well, he's really athletic. He's big and strong in the pocket, and he's got a rifle of an arm.
Pickup of 6, second down and 4. A little razzle and a little bit of dazzle. Here's Giannis Davis, the former 1,000-yard rusher back in 2006. Crosses the 50. Eric Haig coming up with a stop. On the line, they've had to simplify the blocking because, as Matt was talking about in the open, they've had a lot of offensive linemen injured. 3 sophomores there even made some changes an hour before kickoff. Skill position, Davis, who just carried the ball, best rusher. He needs to do more of that. Kevin Jurevich is an outstanding receiver. Third down and 1 for the Spartans. Ball on the Nebraska 49-yard line. 2 tight ends. Davis up the middle, first down and some despair. Breaks into the secondary, still on his feet. Inside the 30, down to the 26-yard line before Cody Glenn made the stop and Nebraska's got a player down.
What a run there from Giannis Davis.
This is a kid that rushed for over 1,000 yards 2 years ago, as we can see. Looks like, is it Barry Turner? Barry Turner's down on the play. Here's the run again.
And San Jose State lines it up against Nebraska's base defense and runs it right at him, right over the top of the center. And how about the effort from Giannis Davis to finish this play? And as a defensive coordinator, that's the one thing that'll drive you crazy, is missed tackles. There you see 1 and 2. Larry Asante misses. 3 from a DB. And finally taken down, Cody Glenn was able to ride him to the turf, but a big-time gain on 3rd and short for San Jose State.
And you can see that Turner's down. Wortman missed the tackle. And as you mentioned, Asante missed the tackle. You want to make sure that this young man's okay, because the coach is talking about his motor last week and how outstanding it was. We're not going to speculate what's going on. And Carl Pellini now will have to go to Pierre Allen, coming in the backup, number 95 for Turner. Turner, though, last week, 3 tackles, a sack. Paid his dues backing up Adam Carricker back in 2006, and he is up. That's good.
Well, you can see right here, you'll see Barry Turner right there. He's got his foot is going to get rolled up on right there. Well, you hate to guess what it might be. But high expectations for Barry Turner here this fall. And Husker fans everywhere hoping he's able to come back.
Yeah, 24 yards on the pickup by Davis. They rushed for only 42 all of last week. Now they get empty out the backfield for Reed. 1st and 10, ball's on the 27-yard line. Reed's pass caught, another first down inside the 15-yard line. Jaleel Beachman, the junior out of San Jose, California, his 5th catch of the year. This is not the same defense we saw last week, Matt.
No, it's not. And you see confidence building in Kyle Reed with every play San Jose State runs. And when you lead a team back to a win like he did a week ago, that gives you a lot of confidence right there. And a strike thrown to the outside. A nice gain there for San Jose State.
And the crowd getting vocal. 1st and 10 from the 12. The Huskers need some type of pressure on Reed. He keeps it right up the middle, breaks a tackle inside the 5, touchdown San Jose State.
And a nice play call from San Jose State. Empty backfield, 5 wide receivers out there for the Trojans, and there's Kyle Reed in the backfield. Just a little quarterback draw, another missed tackle right up the gut, and Reed with that great athleticism able to scamper into the end zone, give San Jose San Jose State an early lead, and this crowd is shocked.
Five plays, 59 yards, about 2 minutes. We told you that Kyle Reed was a dual threat. We saw it there. He passed, he ran. Now, here is a problem, though, for San Jose State. Last week, Strubik missed an extra point and a couple of field goals, so he's been replaced by Will Johnson, a junior, transfer out of Bakersfield College. This is his first Division I kick. And he doesn't get it either. They are 1-for-3 on point afters. Dick Tomey said, I've got to shore this up. Our margin of error is slim. But San Jose State, the first to strike. We're in the first quarter. They lead the Huskers by a touchdown.
Who has the power to harness energy? University of Nebraska Lincoln Research finds answers to global problems. With leading-edge science, we explore renewable energy, reduce the impact of drought, conserve and protect our natural resources. It's clear, the University of Nebraska Lincoln helps keep the planet green. Now that's the power of red.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions. The nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red. Now there's a look at Will Johnson out of Burroughs High School in Bakersfield, California. He's going to lose a little more here if he keeps missing extra points. And let's take a look at them. Here's what happened on that extra point. Good snap. Watch the right upright and dink.
One of the basic parts of football. You want to get that point after. It's usually just an afterthought after scoring a touchdown, and it's an issue. And once it becomes an issue like this, Ron, it gets into the heads of these kickers. And now, who do you go with? I mean, that could be this game, potentially, and the rest of the season, they could have a lot of close games, and that's going to be a big part of things for San Jose State.
It's like a free throw. A lot of guys miss free throws. You've got it. You should get it. And their margin of error is incredibly slim here. And you can see Bo Pelini, I'm sure that he is a little bit concerned, but we even talked to him about this yesterday. He, Carl and Sean Watson, by getting smacked in the mouth early by these guys, and he wanted to see how his players respond. Strubik, the former kicker, maybe the current kicker if Johnson keeps that up. It's going to be a short kick. Alfonso Denard at the 18-yard line. Breaks a couple of tackles, gets up with them 25. They'll probably mark it 26. We have a penalty. Flag down to the 24-yard line. Joel, you have an injury update for us, don't you?
No update as of yet on the health of Barry Turner, but he is being carted off right now. The cart just came over and certainly looking gingerly, unable to walk, so they put him on there and they are bringing him out right now to the locker room, and we will try to update that as soon as we can. Let's go back upstairs to Ron and Matt.
All right, thanks, Joel. Of course, due to some of the hyper regulations, we may not get a complete report on him, but we'll try to find out something.
Well, that's bad news for this Nebraska defense. Barry Turner dropped some weight in the offseason and was really coming into this season known to be the guy that is really going to pressure quarterbacks, and against this open attack from San Jose State, he was going to be a vital part of things today.
Minus 5 yards in that first drive, despite Joe Gans going 2-for-2. Quinton Castile now in the backfield, and he has the football, and he's hit as soon as he gets the handoff. He may lose a yard. Carl Iheanacho on the stop, and we're talking about this defense. They're known for forcing turnovers under Dick Toomey. Schweiger is outstanding, along with Gilbert, Davis, Iheanacho. They've got good quickness linebackers. Keep an eye on Justin Cole. They're going to move him all over the field tonight, looking for that matchup. They probably have two of the best cornerbacks, not only in the WAC, but also in college football with Francis and Owens. You're going to see them going one-on-one with the Nebraska wide receivers. That's why you're seeing a lot of pressure, because you have those lockdown corners. That opens it up for you defensively.
San Jose State definitely going to try to make Nebraska throw the ball today.
Peterson in motion. Gans rolls out. We talked about his mobility. Almost picked off on the play. Looked like Kyle Flynn was able to jump on it. Boy, Flynn was so close to picking that off.
Nebraska shoots themselves in the foot on the kickoff and gets backed up on a holding call all the way back to the 15-yard line. Here they are on second down, and Joe Gans rolling to the right, and dangerous pass there. Good coverage from San Jose State. Nearly a pick.
And we saw 93, Justin Cole, putting some pressure on him. On their nickel package, they will put him down a defensive end, let him rush off the edge. That's where he played last year. Now he's right in the middle as they're jumping around. On second down, pass complete, up to the 24-yard line. Caught by Nate Swift. Pickup of about 11 on the play. That'll be a first down for the Huskers. That looked more like the Nebraska offense we saw last week.
And I think a big play early in this game, Ron. Big third down completion from Joe Gans, and he goes to the bread and butter, Nate Swift, right in the middle of the field. Just a little sit down in the middle of that zone. Mm-hmm. Nate Swift, as a senior, he knows what he's doing in this offense, and he stretches out and barely gets the first down, continues this Nebraska drive.
A little eye formation out, putting Castile at the top of the eye. They're going to run the option. Gans keep running room. Campers out of bounds, just short of the 30-yard line. Is that going to be a penalty? Looked like Gans may have gotten shoved. Travis Jones was tracking him down. The junior out of Atascadero, California.
Well, one of the things Joe Gans talked about this week was Nebraska was potentially going to be able to check into some option attacks. When you see 8-9 guys in the box, checking to an option can be very effective. You see him go out of bounds there. And little contact as he gets to the sideline there.
Ooh, Joe, show him some Chicago, baby. Couple of tight ends now in second and six. Nice ball fake by Gans. Looks short, dumps it off. Peterson, first down, Nebraska. Up over the 41-yard line. Adonis Davis tripping him up, the defensive tackle out of Linwood, California.
Little misdirection from Nebraska's offense. Watch for Todd Peterson going back across the formation there. He was lined up on the left side, ran behind the offensive line, and was out into the flat on the right side where Joe Gans was able to find him for a nice gainer. Misdirection there from Sean Watson in this Nebraska offense.
Now Nebraska goes three wides to the left. Hello in the backfield with Gans. And he'll go from the shotgun. Little movement, penalty flag is thrown. Up to the 48-yard line. Roy Helu is on the carry.
Helu listed as one of the top three backs for Nebraska, with Orr in between all of them. Marlon Lucky usually getting the start, and then Roy Helu and Quentin Castile all getting time. And in talking with Bo Pelini and Sean Watson.
Offside defense, number 95. It's a 5-yard penalty, first down.
Iheanacho with the penalty.
In talking with them, Helu and Castile will probably get more snaps than they did a week ago, even though Helu a week ago did lead Nebraska in rushing with 7 carries for 52 yards.
Well, they were talking about Sean Watson yesterday about rolling in the running backs on 3 plays, giving them all a little taste of it. And I wouldn't be surprised if you see Marcus Mendoza also today. Peterson and Swift wide to the left. First down and 5, ball's on the 46-yard line. Gans has time, looks deep, has to go to his safety valve. Helu's caught, turns on the Jets. Inside the 30, inside the 26-yard line. Roy Francis finally trips him up.
And that's the maturity of Joe Gans in this situation, looking deep down the field, looking for a couple of post routes from his 2 wideouts. And instead, he checks down. Great protection from the offensive line. The check down to the back, out of the backfield. A nice catch and run from Roy Helu. A big time gain for this Nebraska offense.
And another first down. They'll mark the ball on the 26-yard line. Much better than their first possession. 27 yards on that pass and catch. Helu straight up the middle. He has his eyes on the goal line, but comes up 7 yards short. Christopher Owens, and this has gotten the crowd standing.
I think this is the drive that Nebraska was looking for to start the game. But watch Todd Peterson come into the screen here, the wide receiver from the outside, blocked right there on the safety Newsom, and that was able to spring Helu right up the gut.
That's one of the many things this offense did well last week. Coach Gilmore getting his wide receivers to block. Here's Helu again. Gets a block, tripped up at the 5-yard line. That time, Drew Young tried to spring him with that block, wasn't able to. Francis coming up from that quarterback spot, the senior out of Sacramento, California, played a couple of years at Oregon State. That'll bring up a second and goal from the 5-yard line. Doesn't take Nebraska long to score, Matt. And that's what Sean Watson said. He goes, you know, all of a sudden I looked up and, oh, we're in the end zone.
27 touchdowns in 4 games that Joe Gans has started at this school. That's not too bad. You're going to win a lot of football games scoring that many points. Fortunately for Nebraska, they lost 2 of those games.
Let's see if they throw the fade to Swift. They throw it up in the air to Swift. We have a penalty flag. A little shoving in the end zone. He is such a great weapon, Matt. It's 6'5 going up against a 6'1 corner on that fade. We saw it last week for one of his touchdowns. And Joe Gans has the touch on that pass.
Personal foul, defense, number 21. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
Lined up in the slot there, Nate Swift. He goes up just in the slot in a one-on-one matchup, and Joe Gans is going to put it up top. I didn't see the.
Where was that?
Did not see the flag. It might have been right when the ball was snapped. I think he might have lunged at the face mask.
Boy.
There of Nate Swift.
Nevertheless, ball's on the 3-yard line. Castile in the I formation. He's got it. Moving the legs, leaning forward, no sign yet. There it is. Touchdown, Nebraska.
That's the push Nebraska's wanted out of their big offensive line up front. And they bring in their biggest back, Clinton Castile, and go right at the San Jose State defense. Lawson with the lead block. Huff pulls around the outside. And Quentin Castile right up behind his block and into the end zone for a touchdown.
And the extra point. This has been outstanding for Henry. Down and San Jose State, that's how you do it. He remains perfect with point afters this year, 6 for 6. We're going to take a break. Nebraska has taken the lead over San Jose State. Things are right in Lincoln, Nebraska, as the Cornhuskers have taken the lead again, 7-6 here in quarter number one. A crowd of over 84,000 again on hand today. Perfect day for football. This is the kind of day you like. Isn't it, Matt? A little cool, maybe a little rain.
Fall football Saturday in Lincoln, Nebraska. It's tough to beat.
Boy Francis, Brandon Rutley now back for San Jose State. And this is one of the aspects, I think, of the coaches of Nebraska. We see the scoring drive up top there, 86 yards, 9 plays, under 4.5. Their kickoff coverage last week, I wouldn't say was great. They gave up almost 28 yards on kickoff coverage. You get in big A play, you cannot give teams that kind of field position.
Well, that's right. And Adi Kanalik, a guy that kicks it through the end zone, a lot of the time, sometimes that can play with the minds of the guys running down because they think, oh, he's going to kick it through the end zone. Maybe they don't run through the play as much as they should. Western Michigan brought a couple out of the end zone last week, even when he did kick it into the end zone. So you have to go down and, you know, field position in games is so important. You can pin teams back inside their 20-yard line.
10 kickoffs last week, 5 were touchbacks. This one should be a touchback, and it is. Not much of a big breeze, but he drives it through the end zone, and San Jose State will begin 1st and 10 from their own 20. How important is it for San Jose State to show something on this, but more importantly, the Nebraska defense to smack San Jose State in the mouth on this drive?
Well, a year ago, this defense was pretty fragile, Ron, and when they would get down and give up a big, long scoring drive, I think they thought, here we go again. But I don't think that's going to happen with this year's Nebraska defense. They've really taken on the identity of their head coach, Bo Pelini. They're going to be tough, and they're going to respond, I think, after giving up 7 or 6 points in the last drive.
Nebraska showing a little man-on-man coverage from the DBs on the lower portion of your screen. Reed from the shotgun. Hits his player right in a face mask, incomplete. Davis got it right in the kisser. Haven't shown you the starting lineup for the Nebraska defense. Had 4 sacks, forced a couple of turnovers last week. Impressive across the board. Ty Steinkuhler, career high, 8 tackles in that opener. Great job by Cody Glenn. We talked about a week ago. Dillard and Wortman's also going to be joining him. Zanars is out today. O'Hanlon is in. Murillo also back after sitting out last week with back spasms. Second down and 10 for the Spartans. Nebraska showing blitz. They bring five. Here's the pressure. Reed just throws this one up into the cheap seats, and a penalty flag is thrown. Carl Pelini and Bo Pelini both running out on the field on that one.
I think they're going to ask for an intentional grounding call here.
Well, he wasn't outside the tackles. We know that. Sue's the one who put pressure on him.
Roughing the passer.
Oh, my.
Number 93. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
Carl Pelini and Bo Pelini are livid. Now, you have to remember, there's a sideline penalty this year. There's no warnings.
Let's see if Kyle Reed got hit in the face mask here.
That was a point of emphasis, Matt, at the officials meeting in February. If he goes up above with his hands, above the shoulders, that's it.
Oh,
that,
boy,
believe it or not, is the correct call, according to the officials back in July in their meeting in Dallas. First and 10 now for San Jose State. Here comes the pressure again. Reed keeps. Good job. Spins away. Dillard holding on, the junior out of Tulsa Jenks High School. Going back to that last play in July, they brought in officials, about 400 to 500 officials from a number of different conferences, and they also brought in a lot of announcers. And the point of contention was they're going to protect the quarterback this year. And anytime you put hands up, if he's not running the football, if he's back there, it's going to be a personal foul.
And that's awfully tough as a defensive lineman because you have your hands up trying to knock the pass down. So when you come down towards the quarterback, that can happen easily.
First down complete to the 48, to the 50-yard line. Jeff Clark in Nebraska, or Richmond, I should say, in Nebraska territory. Nice job by Reed, though, just going with the flow and showing his mobility again.
Reed just buying time back there in the pocket. He's able to find his man right across the middle. And a nice run after the catch by Richmond. Another first down for San Jose State.
Richmond's first catch of the afternoon, seventh on the year. And again, the San Jose State offense is moving the football. 73 yards already today. Davis dancing around, gets pushed from behind and actually picks up a couple. Phillip Dillard on another tackle. Played every snap versus Western Michigan. I tell you, Dillard was impressive last week, and Wortman didn't get that many snaps at the linebacker spot because they were in the nickel defense a lot. But Dillard, I tell you, he played a lot last week, and it was hot.
He did, and he's the leader of this defense. He, along with Cody Glenn, and you know, Tyler Wortman isn't going to play a lot this year because of the teams that Nebraska is going to face this season. Nebraska's going to be in the nickel a whole bunch of the time defensively with five defensive backs.
Especially for the first five games. Second down and 7. Reed dumps it off. Intercepted, the Huskers! 30, 20, 10! Touchdown, Nebraska, and Dominican Sue!
And what a big play for this Nebraska defense as San Jose State once again driving on Nebraska. Made it past midfield, and a mistake from Kyle Reed in the pocket, and Dominican Sue able to get that big mid up, not only pick it off but keep his feet and get in there for 7 points. Cody Glenn comes on the blitz, and it was Potter who was able to get his hand up and knock it down, and in Dominican Sue was there to grab it after Potter knocked it down.
An outstanding play. That is the capital L in Lumber. 84 consecutive PATs now dating back to 2006 for Nebraska. I think Sue's gas tank may be a little on empty right about now. I tell you, he showed some speed, though. I mean, it wasn't like he was being timed with an hourglass, but it wasn't bad. 49 yards on the return. Let's take a look at it again from high up top.
Dominican Sue in the middle there with Zach Potter. You see Potter get his hand up, knock it down, and Dominican Sue's able to grab it. And I think everyone was just kind of shocked what happened to the football. Sue was able to grab it, and you're right. Nice athleticism there to get back down the field and get it in there for the touchdown. Sue has high expectations this year, Ron.
Yeah.
in his junior
year. He was criticized last year.
Yeah, he was. You know, high expectations, even though he was a sophomore last year. And now he comes back as a junior. And everyone expecting him to have a big-time season for Nebraska.
How disappointing if you're San Jose State. Not only do you give up the interception for a TD, but he outruns your running backs and wide receivers.
Well, that's a little disappointing.
Yeah, watch him, because nobody actually catches up to him. And here's Potter with a tip.
Freeze it right there. You'll see Zach Potter gets his hand on it there. And then as we keep rolling here, Ndamukong Suh's able to grab it right off an offensive lineman there for San Jose State. Looked like it might have hit
Connie.
And then into Sue's hands. And now he's getting congratulated over there. Zach Potter deserves a lot of credit for that play, though. Getting that big mid up. Potter at 6 feet, 7 inches tall, is able to go up and knock it down.
Looked like it went off John Connie's shoulder on that. Now, how long is it going to take before Sue goes up to coach and say, you know, I can play wide receiver? There it is. Watch it again. Hit Connie, the left tackle from San Jose State.
Left hand of Potter off his helmet. Went right off of Connie's helmet. Good hands there from Sue, huh? For a big man.
Absolutely.
Able to snatch it out of the sky.
Rutley and Francis now back. They are stunned. They took a 7-0 lead to Nebraska. 14 unanswered points. Adi does the job again. 2 for 2. Rutley will take a seat.
It's just a dream for an offensive lineman to have that happen, and not only to pick it off and get to run with it, but then get a score, a touchdown. Sue's never going to forget that play. And what a big play in this game, Ron, because San Jose State had gained a little confidence at that point, only down 7-6. They marched right down the field on their first drive. They were moving the football on their second drive of the game. And Kyle Reed gets his pass knocked down and picked off for 7 points, and all of a sudden you're down 14-6, starting at your 20-yard line. It's important here, I think, that they get a couple of first downs.
Once again, Barry Turner hurt. Pierre Allen is in, the sophomore out of Denver's Thomas Jefferson High School at defensive end. First and 10. Reed looks, fires across the middle, wide open to Richmond, another first down. You talked early about how Reed can throw it on a rope. We saw it there.
What a great play caller from San Jose State. Little misdirection, faking the handoff in the backfield. And then Kyle Reed running the option, and then pulling up. And you see Richmond put his hand up there right in the middle of the field in the seam between the safety and the cornerback. Nebraska playing deep thirds. Cover three, and Richmond right in between them in the seam. And a nice throw from Kyle Reed.
28 yards on the reception, first and 10 again. A little pitch, it's Richmond, looks for a block, got it inside the 40, goes down at the 37-yard line by Matt O'Hanlon, but another first down with 2:33 left in the first.
In motion, the motion man there. Comes down through motion. Just pitches it right to him there, and he has that momentum going across the field. And you see the block at the bottom of the screen by Beachman there on Anthony West, knocks him down, and that was able to spring him for an extra 10 yards. Nice throw from Richmond.
Well, the defense of Nebraska has got to stand tall now. Three wide receivers to the right, one to the left. Reed looks. A little dump pass. Asante wrapping up Ryan Ellidge, the tight end out of Newhall, California. Now, one thing you have to say about this, though, in talking to the coaches and even the San Jose State offensive coordinator, Arroyo and Steve Martin told me on Wednesday, said, we've got the advantage because they don't know what we're going to do. And even the Nebraska coaches said, we're not sure if it's the San Jose State offense from last year or are they going to be new this year. So there was a question mark on how this offense would play out.
Right now we're seeing the open, wide open sets, three, four wide receivers, one back in the backfield.
Rutley breaks the tackle straight ahead inside the 25. Another first down before Sue comes up with a stop.
Well, we've seen Giannis Davis break some tackles. Now it's Brandon Rutley in the backfield. A little read option here. Kyle Reed gives it to Rutley, the little man, and a missed tackle there. Ty Steinkuhler not quite able to get him to the ground. And he squirts up through the middle for a first down.
133 yards in this opening quarter already for San Jose State.
1:17 left in the quarter. First and 10. Nebraska only brings four. Reed's got time. Rifles the pass. Almost picked off. Incomplete. Eric Hag looked like he had his hand on it. Intended for Jurevich, their best receiver, who was double covered on that play.
A nice coverage from the Nebraska secondary. Good protection. Give some credit to this San Jose State offensive line.
Oh.
And Hag right down the middle.
Oh.
And O'Hanlon over the top, so double coverage. Trying to squeeze one in there to Jurevich.
Hag almost didn't turn around in time. 64 seconds left in the quarter.
Empty backfield, five wideouts.
Rutley goes in motion. The handoff to Rutley. Nice job covering him up quickly. Maybe picks up 2 yards, and Dominican Sue again as the interception for a touchdown and another tackle. That'll set up a third down at about 8 as we go inside of 50 seconds in the quarter.
Very important that Nebraska stays to their technique and their scheme. Stay in your lanes defensively. When teams are running the read option, you have to stick with the game plan, stay in your lane, and don't go with all of the misdirection.
Third down and 8. Here comes the blitz, and he is going to go down at the 25-yard line. Anthony West didn't hesitate. He led the charge, may not have brought him down. Cody Glenn was the one who did, but I think the fact that West showed and went is the thing that really sparked this blitz.
There was a blitz, and look how many guys are up near the line of scrimmage for Nebraska there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 guys up near the line of scrimmage for Nebraska, and they're coming after Kyle Reed. They're not going to let him stand back there and pick them apart. And that's why they're able to get pressure on him. So 9 guys within a couple of yards of the line of scrimmage there, Ron.
Well, that's going to be the end of the first quarter. San Jose State is going to come out and attempt a field goal. Carl Pelini's defense, however, gets stung for 133 yards on that first quarter, 66 rushing. But they have the lead. Those are the important numbers. 14-6 as we head to quarter number 2. Moments away from quarter number 2 beginning. Nebraska leads at 14-6. Let's check in with our man on the sideline, Joel Goldberg. Joel.
All right, Ron, thanks a lot. We are joined by former Nebraska All-American, former Olympic champion Rulon Gardner is here. Got one of the loudest ovations of the day. What's that like to walk back here into the stadium and get such a massive ovation?
Well, I played spring ball my senior year in college at Nebraska and never played out for the team. So it's amazing to walk out here in front of all the fans and to see Nebraska red here. It's something that you can't describe, and it's something, you know, for a wrestler to come here, it's amazing to see the dreams come true.
You won Olympic gold. You were just over there in China as well as a commentator. What's it like when you win? How much does your life change after coming back as a gold medalist?
Well, you know, depending on how and what you do with it, what your goal is. Some people don't want to do much with it. They want to just get back to training. You know, I had the opportunity to go back. I graduated with a teaching degree, and you get to go in and make a difference in people's lives. You know, if you want to go out there, you can really change a kid forever. And I get the opportunity to go speak to over 100,000 kids a year, and that's a dream come true, is making a difference in a kid's life.
Rulon, appreciate the visit.
Thank you.
All right, that is former Olympic champion Rulon Gardner. Said the food wasn't so great over there in China, but they did find a couple of McDonald's, guys.
All right, Johnson's 42-yarder going to be no good. So last week, San Jose State 0 for 2 on field goals, 1 for 2 on point afters, losing 7 points. And already this afternoon, they've lost 4 points.
Such a big part of a game, special teams play, especially when you're going to score. And he just blocks it, pushes it to the right. You see the reaction. He knew right from the time. He left his foot. Looked like a good snap and hold, but a push to the right. He missed the fairway.
Something we do know a little of. Peterson goes in motion. Huskers take over the running game. Over the 30 to the 32-yard line. Pick up about 7. Christopher Owens on the stop. Now, if you're Dick Tomey down at San Jose State, you, you've got to be saying, my goodness, guys, we can't do that. We're moving the football. We've almost doubled him in yardage. There's Dick Tomey, the veteran coach who was very successful at Hawaii. And, of course, most of you remember him at Arizona, was an assistant coach at Texas in 2004. And he told me, he said, my guys are going to play hard, but we need to score when we can, and we've got to make the best of things when we can.
Well, it's so frustrating for an offense. You drive down the field, you get a chance to put points on the board, and you come up empty.
Second and short for Nebraska. You love this situation. Four. Joe Gans is going to go up top. He's got his man complete. Swift. Another first down in Spartan territory to the 46. Evan Newsom on the coverage.
Nate Swift with a big play here. We see him right down here in the slot, and he's going to run a little flag route. Joe Gans with great time and throws a strike out there to Nate Swift. He had a big game last week, Nate Swift. Five catches, 121 yards, and two touchdowns. I think the favorite target of Joe Gans.
I would have to think so. 23 yards on the pickup. Swift now already three receptions today. He had five last week. First down, and Nebraska's offense putting yardage up. Gans, nice pitch to Lucky. Tries to get the corner. Hesitates a little bit. Everybody clears out on the sideline. He gets inside the 45. Take a look at those first quarter stats. You can see the numbers, and the thing that stands out is the rushing yards for San Jose State. 66 yards in that opening quarter. This is a team that could not rush the football last year. In fact, they only averaged 83 a game.
And Nebraska stout against the rushing game a week ago for Western Michigan. So that's probably the biggest disappointment right there. And when you have a dual threat quarterback, we talked about Joe Gans being able to use his feet, Kyle Reed, same thing. Puts a lot of pressure on a defense when you have to account for a quarterback that can scramble.
On second down, Lucky, no place going. Gets stood up right away by Jerron Gilbert, a senior out of Chino, California. His dad, Deron, played for the Saints, was an offensive lineman back in 85 and 88. He's a second team all WAC. First of two games against WAC teams. Of course, New Mexico State. Hal Mumme coming next week. That'll also be pay-per-view, by the way. You talk about a wide open offense. Well, Nebraska, it makes this one look conservative.
Right, and Nebraska's going to see that all season, yeah. Even when they get into conference play with Texas Tech and Kansas and Missouri. Even Oklahoma runs a pretty wide open offense. Colorado. So Nebraska's going to face a lot of these same sorts of offenses. Offenses that spread you out across the football field.
We've got a procedure penalty. That'll be against Nebraska. And that'll be their fourth penalty already in this game.
Ball start, number 24. Offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
And you can't have that from a wide receiver.
Did you ever have that happen to you?
Miles Paul.
I mean, did you ever move? And I'm sure Coach Osborne or
I never got caught.
Did Coach Brown catch you, though?
I usually had one holding call a year, and that guy right there, Ron Brown, would usually make sure that didn't ever happen.
Yes. Yes,
of course, he was kind of like my dad, too, so I didn't want to let him down.
Third down at 14, and we have another whistle and another penalty flag, and it's going to go against Nebraska again. Another procedure penalty. Randy Crystal, one of the outstanding veteran officials,
with
the call.
Number 44, offense. 5-yard penalty, third down.
Well, Mike McNeil gets the honors, and that's one of Ron Brown's guys.
And he is not going to be happy with that. But a great job, I thought, by Bo Pelini, going back to the roots of Nebraska football. And he and Ron Brown hadn't spoken since Bo had left. And before Bo left in 03, he told Coach Brown, if I'm ever a head coach, I'd love you to be on my staff. And Coach Brown stuck around here in Lincoln and worked with the FCA.
Yep.
And then got the call from Bo Pelini to come back and
be on staff. Oh, my goodness, not again. And it is another procedure penalty. Three in a row. This is going to be mentally cold, I think.
Right. 5-yard penalty, down.
I believe you're right, it was mentally cold. So you have two wide receivers and a tight end. How many times have you ever seen that in a game? Without three penalties in a row, procedure, and none of them are on the offensive line.
Seven penalties in the first half. That is not good. They had six the entire game. And Bo telling us yesterday, hey, our guys should be better this game. There's a big jump in improvement between the first and the second game because you're done with that first game jitters, but it's not showing right now. Third and very long. Gans going across the middle, almost intercepted.
just in a tough situation, obviously, when it's third and that long. Joe Gans has time in the pocket, uses his patience, steps up in the pocket nicely. You'll see. Great defense there.
Boy, Francis.
Francis is able to come right around Henry and get his mitts in there, just about pick it off. Going to force a punt from Nebraska.
Well, we talked about Francis being a great cornerback. Now he's back to receive the kick inside the 20-yard line. Kitchener standing on his 26. Good snap, no pressure, nice spirally kick. Francis will take it. It's up to about the 25-yard line, 7 yards on the return. Armando Murillo on the stop, so San Jose State will take over. We're in the second quarter, 10:59 left to play before intermission. Bo Pelini and company lead by 8.
We're on a journey of discovery, a journey that is unlocking the secrets of disease at the genetic level. The result? Revolutionary cancer vaccines and research breakthroughs in Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. And with every discovery, we provide new knowledge to thousands and new hope, one patient at a time. We've always been pioneers. It's the frontiers that have changed.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions. The nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
Welcome back. San Jose State struck first. Kyle Reed on a 12-yard run. Nebraska answered with 14, and that's where we are right now. Huskers back at Memorial Stadium next Saturday night to take on New Mexico State. You can watch the game on television via pay-per-view. Call your cable or satellite provider or visit Huskers.com for more information. Kickoff, 6 p.m. Central Daylight Time. Matt and I will be back in another wide-open offense. And here comes that San Jose State offense that already has 133 yards. But the key to them, they've been running the football well. They finished 112th last year in rushing. Last week, they only had 42 yards rushing, most of those coming from Reed.
Well, they're spreading this Nebraska defense out all across the field. So far, having success moving the football.
When Nebraska has blitzed, it's been successful. Here they come again. This time Reed reads it well. Over the 40, up to the 45-yard line. Matt O'Hanlon in the secondary bringing him down. He is a talented young man, but he read where that blitz was coming from, and he made his move.
Well, when you have five wide receivers to cover, a back out of the backfield, there's no one on Reed, and he saw it and squirted right through the defensive line. Before you know it, he's in the secondary with that big body. He's not afraid to take on contact when he gets into the secondary at 6'3 and 215. Bigger than most safeties he's going to see.
Mm-hmm. And Robbie Reed, the center for San Jose State, had a nice block on Ty Steinkuhl, who dominated last week. Again, Nebraska's showing blitz. Six on the line. They only bring four. Pass is complete. Jeff Clark dropped after a short gain. Larry Asante on the coverage, the junior out of Alexandria, Virginia.
And even there, where it looks to be a nice tackle from Nebraska, it was a nice gain. 5.5 yards, mm-hmm. 6 yards. Gets San Jose State in a second and medium. Just where you want to be, already at midfield.
And once again, the no-huddle offense. And that's one of the things that really bothered the defense in Nebraska last week, believe it or not, was the 42nd play clock. It's time to hand off. Rutley spinning around, he's got a first down, still on his feet. He's going to have to be gang tackled inside the 40 down the 38-yard line. Right now, I think it's fair to say that the San Jose State line is doing a nice job on the defensive line.
They are doing a nice job. You'll see in the middle, it's just man on man. Steinkuhler getting blocked. Dillard getting blocked right in the middle there. And before you know it, you just need that little gap. And you'll see big, big offensive line gaps there. Mm-hmm. And that spreads your defensive line out. And if you get a body on a body with a little scat back, he's able to squirt through there. And we've seen it plenty of times here today already.
First and 10, now ball sitting at about the 37-yard line.
Dennis Davis back in the backfield, and Reed doesn't like what he sees. He's going to whistle the timeout. Play clock was also going down. 170 yards already for San Jose State.
With this no-huddle offense of San Jose State, they have a couple of players on the side of the field that are signaling the plays in. They weren't able to get it in there.
Dick Tomey likes what he sees so far from his squad. They only trail by eight. San Jose State doing a nice job so far, but they still trail the Huskers by 8, 14-6. Matt Davison, Joel Goldberg with you. Dick Tomey, in his fourth year as the head coach, took over a program that was on life support between 92 and 2006. This San Jose State team had one winning record, and that was 2000. He said, I said, why did you take over this program? It was dead. He said, it was a challenge. He's got 18 wins in a couple of years. That's the most of any three-year period in the last couple of decades for San Jose State.
A well-respected coach.
Absolutely.
Across the country.
First and 10 for his Spartans. Huskers rush five. Reed steps up in the pocket, able to make a little bit, maybe picking up two. This time Ty Steinkuhler did a nice job of shedding the block, making the tackle. Dillard also in on the stop.
Ty Steinkuhler right there in the middle of the line of scrimmage. You see him getting held up, trying to use his hands, get the blocker off of him, able to just get an ankle there from Kyle Reed. Steinkuhler played a whale of a game last week, having eight tackles for that Nebraska defense.
Had only 13 all of last year. Now Giannis Davis goes wide out to the side. Nebraska's showing blitz again. Reed barking out the numbers. Here comes the blitz. He reads it, dumps it off, pass. Jurevich gets away from the defense. Gets a block inside the 20 down to the 18-yard line. Murillo finally on the stop. He is their best receiver. This is only his 14th game at wide receiver. He was a safety.
Jurevich right there in the middle of the field. And he's going to get hit from Kyle Reed. Shakes one tackle. And I think if he had to do this again, he'd get upfield a little quicker. I think he'd have gotten more yards, scampered around a little bit. But kind of a scat wide receiver once he catches it.
Well, it's first and 10 on the 20-yard line. Reed tucks it again. This time, no place to go. He's going to lose five. Pierre Allen subbing for Barry Turner led the charge. Also, Cody Glennon on the stop.
Nowhere to go. You're looking for an alley there as a quarterback. And you see the nice job by the defensive line, really standing everyone up on the defensive line and not allowing any running lanes there for Kyle Reed. And that puts this offense in a tough position at second and 15, not only because they feel they have to get a first down,
right,
Ron. They don't want to be in a kicking situation because we know what a debacle that's been last week and here again this week.
Well, it's second down and 15. Five wide receivers set. The splits of the offensive linemen are wide, a la Texas Tech. Reed looking for Paydirt. Has a man off the fingertips of Jurevich. Merrick Haig on the coverage, and he got the wind knocked out of him. He hit hard.
That's exactly what happened. I think he's going to be fine, but he came down flat on his back. Jurevich, look at the throw. The accuracy from Kyle Reed. One-on-one coverage right down the seam. You go to your best wide receiver, Jurevich. It was nice coverage there. Moved his head on the coverage. Just off the fingertips of Jurevich.
Third down and long. The crowd is loud.
Time out here.
And Nebraska with already a bunch of penalties in this ball game. They've got six in the ball game for 45 yards, and they want to make sure they get things right. They don't want to give up any points. This Bellini's looking on. There's Kyle Reed, who's done a pretty decent job today throwing the football. He's 7 of 11, 89 yards. Let's look at this Jurevich off his fingertips again. He needed about two more inches.
Nice tight spiral there. Good looking pass from Kyle Reed.
Did he jump off his wrong foot?
Well, I think he got caught in between strides, and that can happen, and you're not able to get the lift that you try to get. When you're going full speed, it's tough to jump up in the air. You can jump out when you're going full speed, but to be able to jump up is sometimes difficult when you're going as fast as you can. Just off the fingertips of Jurevich, and he came down smack on his back. Just knocked the wind out of him. He'll be fine.
Okay, so let's go into the Nebraska huddle. Bullpen.
Emeritus.
He stressed scheme. He stressed fundamentals this week. Said, listen, I'm tired of talking about the spread. We need to play our defense. It'll take care of itself. What's he telling his troops now?
Well, I think he's going to make sure that no matter what they come out in, everybody's on the same page as far as their checks defensively and who has who, because communication was an issue last year, offense on offense and defense,
right,
with young guys that were inexperienced. And we talked with Coach Pelini and Sean Watson and Carl Pelini about, you know, guys being able to settle in week two. You normally see the best improvement from game one to game two. Last week, you have a lot of new faces, guys that hadn't played in a big-time college football game before. And so they have that one game under their belt. Now you don't want to have that happen here in week two. We've seen some mental errors with the penalties. But I think he's just making sure everyone's on the same page. I don't think he's going to let Kyle Reed stand back there and pick Nebraska apart on this 3rd-and-14 play. I think you're going to see some sort of pressure from Nebraska's defense try to make Kyle Reed make a play.
I've got to admit, I'm a little surprised we haven't seen more pressure. But, you know, they know a lot more, a heck of a lot more about it than I do. But all right, here's the situation. 3rd-and-15, ball's on the 24-yard line. Davis joins Reed in the backfield. 7 on the line of scrimmage for the Huskers. An 8th is sneaking up. They bring 6. Reed chased from behind. Throws, pass, incomplete. Eric Haig was on the coverage as Reed took a seat on the turf. Good pressure there. Made him go to the left. He's not as good throwing going that way as he is going to the right.
He got pushed out of the pocket. You'll see Haig come around from the left side of the screen. But that athleticism of Kyle Reed, and he got popped. But the athleticism bought just enough time that he was able to get it off Pierre Allen. Gave him a little shot.
Yeah.
And here we go back to the kicking game.
Oh, well, this is going to be exciting. It's going to be placed on the 31, a 41-yard field goal attempt. The kick is up, and it is good. Strubik comes back in for the kick after being benched at the start of this game. He was 0 for 2 last week, missed a couple from 42 and 43. This time he hits one from 41 yards.
And this is a big confidence boost right here.
Didn't exactly drive through the goalpost, though.
No, it was a little bit of a draw.
Yeah,
a little right, to the left. And just snuck it in the right side of the goalpost there. But, you know, that would have been tough for this offense to swallow had they come away empty again after moving the ball on Nebraska. 183 yards of offense already from San Jose State.
Well, there's Keith Burns, his defensive coordinator, former Tulsa head coach, talking to Dick Tomey. Now, the problem for this team is depth is a problem. So if it's a game of attrition today, Nebraska will win it handily, because for a school this size, they only have 60 to 70 scholarship players because the ARP got them, and they're trying to rectify that situation. You can't redshirt. You got to have these kids play. A ton of freshmen play for this team. But he said, listen, Boise State, Fresno State, they've overcome it. We need to find a way to overcome it. But he knew if this is a battle today of depth, they will not win that battle.
It just makes it really hard on you when you travel as a team. You come in here, and if you do have to play 75, 80 snaps on defense or offense, yeah, it can just really wear a team out. Not to mention, if you have any injuries, you're in big trouble. We talked about the offensive line not having only 4 starts amongst all of the starters coming into this season. So no experience there. So if you do get an injury, you know, you're really getting thin up front. You won't hear them complain, will you?
No.
Complaining. I mean, they know, hey. And, you know, and as we stand up here and say that, 19, 20, 21-year-old kids, they're pretty resilient.
Yeah,
and really, you know, I don't remember being really tired as a football player when you're 20 years old.
Right.
You know, you should be in good shape. And yeah, you might get worn down a little bit, but these guys can go a long time.
These are the guys that go to bed at 2 in the morning. So
they're in a little better shape than you and I.
Well, there's a very animated discussion between the Pelinis. And one of the things Carl told us, he goes, listen, I am on the exact same page as Bo. These two have a very special and incredible relationship, and I'm sure that they're breaking this down, why this defense has given up 183 yards in the first half.
Well, Bo calls the defense, but he's in constant communication with his brother Carl.
Alfonso Denard from about the 2-yard line looking for a block, doesn't get it.
steps aside from one tackler, throws one away. Still on his feet, loses about three, and finally is pushed back to about the 12-yard line. He got up to about the 17, then he ran negative yards.
Well, he got knocked backwards, but he didn't go to the ground.
Yeah.
Kept his feet about him, and really at that point didn't have a choice. Tries to cut it back here, freshman Denard. A lot of potential for Nebraska. Sheds a tackle, and then kind of momentum took him backwards. I don't think he was intending to go backwards.
Turned into a human pinball there, didn't he?
It just puts your offense in a difficult position. Yeah. You're looking at an 87-yard field in front of you.
Well, you see the numbers on Joe Gantz, 5 of 8, 77 yards. No touchdowns, no interceptions. Helu's now getting the call in the backfield. He's 7 yards deep, and he has the football. Nope. Nothing doing. Stood up right at the line of scrimmage. In fact, he may have lost a yard. Coy Francis from that cornerback spot was also there.
Yeah, they brought a corner blitz. I believe Francis came off the right side. Helu had nowhere to go, losing. See a little corner blitz from the bottom of the screen there, Francis. And he really disrupts the play, forces Helu back to the right side. And a good job of contain the defensive line of San Jose State. Now Nebraska in a second and 12. So far, play selection for Nebraska, 12 run, 8 pass here in this game. So really trying to establish the running game.
Well, three-step drop, Gans flushed. Looking, still looking, and he is going to be dragged down at the 8-yard line. No, he's still on his feet. The officials didn't knock him down. And he goes up to the 21-yard line. Everybody stopped, and the San Jose State players are pointing at the officials saying, you marked him down.
Wow.
I never heard a whistle.
It was one of those where he gets pulled to the ground and he rolls over the top of the defender, so the whistle was never blown.
It looked like that one knee did hit there. And let's see.
Yeah, that,
nope.
He was really close.
Good heads up by Joe Gans.
It's hard to tell if his knee hit the
and
ground.
And it's going
to
be reviewed.
Take one more look at it. Has to be conclusive evidence that his knee hit the ground. Let's see.
Oh, yeah.
And it did.
It did.
And it did. So this one's most likely going to come back.
It's obviously going to. Randy Cristall will talk to the guys upstairs. Point of emphasis at those officials meetings I was talking about, also replay, that the NFL doesn't replay a bunch of unnecessary ones. In other words, if it's a play that doesn't have a whole lot of bearing on the game, forget about it. One of the things they wanted to do is get up to the booth as quickly as possible and make a definitive decision. You can see there clearly his left knee is down.
And that's going to take Nebraska. And this is a significant play here, Ron, and this is one they should review.
Yeah.
He was drugged down somewhere around the 8-yard line, it looks like. He takes the ball out to the 20-yard line. So instead of a third and 16, Nebraska is in a third and 3 the way it stands right now.
Right.
And will be punting out of their own end zone if they don't do anything on third down if this thing gets reversed.
Once again, not much of a breeze here. Randy Cristall still upstairs. Bo Pelini waiting. Yeah, San Jose State coaches looking, told to get on their own sideline. Dick Tomey was actually offered the athletic director's job at Hawaii this year when June Jones left. Said, no, I'm staying. I like these guys. Yeah.
There it is. You can see it. His knee did hit the ground. But great presence there from Joe Gans. Give him credit.
The heads up
play.
You
keep playing. You didn't hear a whistle, keep going.
That's right. I'm surprised it's taken this long, to be honest with you.
I am too. He's
it looked
probably
pretty clear to us.
Probably seen two or three different replays by now.
And they're still having a powwow with the officials. We've got 5:33 left in the half, 14-9. And you know, it's so funny because San Jose State has such great momentum now. They got it back with that field goal. What's this do for that team? And Nebraska was trying to get something going. Now everybody's standing around getting cool.
How many times?
As a player, how did it feel for you?
How many times in a game have you seen this? Whether it's an injury or a replay. And even an injury you can put up with because you're worried about the health of a student athlete. In this situation, you know, with a replay, you want to get that decision made and let's get the action going again. It takes the air out of the sails of the players and the crowd.
Well, this is longer than the 90 seconds they wanted. Randy Cristall taking off a headset. Here it is.
After video review, it indicates the runner was down on the 9-yard line. Third down. Please put 5:38 on the game.
And maybe that's what took a little while, Ron, was seeing the spot.
That's
not
right.
Just
call.
The knee down, but maybe, hey, where do we spot the football? And now they've got it down at the 9-yard line, so that'll bring up a third and long here for Nebraska.
Well, Justin Cole was the man there. We talked about him. He's a guy that was a defensive end his freshman year and a little bit last year. He's very active, so now they're facing third down and 14 from the 9. And Gans will go from the shotgun. Here comes a little bit of pressure, steps up, plenty of time, throws into the flat up to the 20-yard line. Niles Paul with a reception. But it'll be 3 yards short of the first down. Now you took like 3 steps back on that. I saw you move in your
Well, I know what Niles Paul was thinking on this play that he needed to just make the catch. As a freshman, he didn't want to make a mistake, and he wants to make sure and corral the ball. And there's Joe Gann's reaction. He says, come on, partner, you got to try to keep your feet there. Know where you're at on the football field.
Yeah.
Know it's third and 15, and you got to try to keep your feet and get upfield and get that first down. He was pretty open there. There was no defender within 5 or 6 yards of him. If he would have been able to keep his feet, probably would have been able to scamper for the first down.
That sets up a 4th down and 2 from the 21-yard line. Ed Titchener standing at his 6. Francis back at the 40. This is a wobbly kick. He's going to hit it about the 48-yard line. Francis decides to pick it up. He's got some speed. He sees nothing but red jerseys. Let's try this way. Have a seat, Mr. Francis.
And that's nice coverage from Nebraska's punt squad there. Francis didn't know for sure if he wanted to pick up that punt or not as it rolled, and he ended up losing over 10 yards on the return.
Well, the Nebraska defense coming back up on the field so far. They've given up 183 yards, and everybody's wondering, when are they going to get the black shirts? And Bo Pelini says, when they earn them. And he's very emphatic about it, and I agree.
Well, he's going to make these guys go out and make sure that they know they deserve these black shirts. And I don't think 1 week against Western Michigan, giving up over 300 yards passing, was the week that they earned it.
5 wide receivers. Davis in the backfield finally sets to the left of Reed. He's got it. Chased down from behind. And Dominican Sue is the one who ran down the running back. Do you think that maybe Cody Glenn could have gotten a black shirt after last week's performance, or were there too many mental errors?
Well, right, and that's one of the debates is when he gives out black shirts, Bo Pelini, will he give 11 black shirts out? Or
yes.
Will he give out only 4 after one certain week?
Good point.
And do you earn it as a squad, as a unit, or do you individually earn your black shirt? I would think Cody Glenn was the closest one last week. He was everywhere.
Well, nobody expected this game to be this close at this point in time. Kyle Reed looks, fires, pass complete up to the 41-yard line. David Richmond on the reception. Richmond with his 3rd catch already this afternoon. Asante on the coverage, and another completion for Kyle Reed. He has an interception, but that's kind of like with an asterisk.
Right,
it wasn't like an interception. Returned for a touchdown by Sue, so this potent Nebraska offense only responsible for 7 points in this first half.
And San Jose State's defense has been stingy, no doubt. Big play here at 3rd and short.
Straight ahead. Reed just puts his head down and picks up about 3, stopping the clock. 3:44 left in the half.
What a momentum boost it would be for San Jose State. See Reed, the offensive line just squeezes down, and on a quarterback sneak, they're able to get nearly 5 yards. What a confidence boost it would be for this squad, huh? Right now, if they could go down and put more points on the board, even take the lead here before the half, possibly.
You know, we talked about them playing 3 quarterbacks. Kyle Reed has solidified himself this afternoon. 1st and 10, Reed back to pass. Here comes some pressure.
He tucks the football as he gets up over the 45, past the line of scrimmage by a yard. Pierre Allen and Dominican Sue putting on the pressure.
And that doesn't look like much there, but when you have an athletic quarterback, right. Instead of being a 3 or 4 yard loss, he's able to gain a yard. And that just puts you in a much better down and distance. And as the game wears on, how many times have we seen him fall forward, get a couple more yards here, a couple more yards there? Both of these quarterbacks are able to do that and put their offenses in much better situations.
Well, second down and 9 inside of 3 minutes to play in the first half. Nebraska brings 5. Getting away from Cody Glenn is Kyle Reed. Glenn had a shot at him. Ty Steinkuhler did, and he made sure he put him down. Glenn just got an arm on him. You know, we talk about making that improvement from first and second game, but can that also maybe have an opposite effect? Because you have, like, Cody Glenn, not saying he's playing poorly today, but he has such a great game, the expectations were so high.
Well, it could happen for sure, and especially if you're just not in a position to make plays, because there are games that you just don't end up around the football if they go the other direction, if they don't throw it to your guy. And that's what we've seen here today, I think.
Third down and 8. They rush 4. Reed going down, throwing this one up. That should be a penalty, but we do have a flag already at the 45-yard line. That was thrown before the play was finished.
So we could have offsetting penalties. It's probably going to be defensive pass interference and then a grounding call.
I'm not sure, because that flag at the 45 went down very early. Then we had the grounding call. Not a smart play by Kyle Reed. Got to learn to eat the football sometimes.
Looked like Asante might have been involved. A little altercation at the bottom of the field there.
There's Randy Cristall again.
There are 2 fouls. Play. Intentional grounding. Offense. Foul. Hands to the face, number 6 on defense. The penalty's offset, 3rd down.
All right, 7th penalty on Nebraska. That'll only be the 3rd on San Jose State. Once again, it's a point of emphasis this year. You cannot put your hands on somebody's face.
Major.
That's kind of ticky-tacky there, though.
Well, that looks like Armando Murillo out there.
Now we go back.
So we have offsetting penalties, and we'll do 3rd down over again.
3rd down and 8. A lot of jumping around on defense. 4 in the box. Nebraska rushes 4. Reed steps up in the pocket, fires, pass complete, short of the first down. Ball is loose. Officials finally call it dead at the 45-yard line. That'll be a yard short. Terrence Williams on the reception.
What do you do here?
You know,
4th and 1, you'd think you'd punt, but you know what? If you're San Jose State,
well, first, if I'm Dick Tomey, I ask for a measurement, even though you know it's short. You want to see exactly how short it is. And that might be what he's doing. Or he's going to call the timeout.
Nebraska's
going to burn the timeout.
I think Bo Pelini was thinking San Jose State could potentially come out with that quick snap.
Yeah.
And get that good push up front as they did a couple of plays ago. See the time Kyle Reed has in the pocket, the great presence. The size at 6'3", and it's well short of a first down, but good job of stretching out there by Terrence Williams.
You know, we talked about the black shirts, and Adam Character, former Husker, obviously playing in the NFL, knows something about earning that black shirt.
I think it lost its prestige. You know, when I was there was about like 15, 16 guys getting it, which is a good thing, but at the same time, it kind of loses, you know, its honor. It's supposed to be the starters, and even sometimes, you know, all the starters didn't get it before I got there. So it brings back its prestige, and what an honor it is to have a black shirt.
And I'm sure as a former player, you appreciate that honor. And by the way, San Jose State is going to go ahead and kick it away. Philip Zavala, the junior out of San Bruno, California, standing on his own 41-yard line.
And when your defense is playing as well as San Jose State's has, why not?
Nate Swift on his 10. And he tries to kick this high, so no return, and it's going to hit. Oh, nice bounce, and they're going to down it right at the 8-yard line. Probably could have gone a couple of more yards, but why take that chance, right? Don't get greedy. Josh Harrison, redshirt freshman out of Oxnard, California, nice job. And I'm sure the coaches could would have said, let it go another yard, but you're not, you know.
Well, you want to make sure and grab it. I think they could have probably got it down all the way to the 1-yard line had he waited. But you're going to make a Nebraska offense go 91 yards that in a minute 25 that has 111 yards of total offense here in the first half. That said, this is where Joe Gans is at his best. Three wide receivers and a tight end and one back in the backfield, and he wants to go down and try to get some points here before half.
We haven't seen Joe run the ball a lot, and that's what we talked about in the open, his mobility. This time he throws the deep out. It's going to be intercepted at the 30-yard line. Duke Iheanacho looks like the one who picked it off. His first interception, not only this year, for his career, the sophomore out of Carson, California, whose brother's the defensive end. Not a good pass for Joe Gans. Third interception of the year.
And that gives great field position, obviously, to San Jose State. Joe Gans had time. He was looking for Nate Swift on a flag route. Iheanacho just fell off the play, was in a zone, and went back and picked it off.
And now, with minute 17 to play, San Jose State can add more points on the board. They're at the 30. Left hash. The fake to Davis. Reed looks, fires inside the 25, caught by Jeff Clark, who gets a helmet depleter.
Got his helmet knocked off.
Senior out of Torrance, California, spent some time at L.A. Harbor College. Was a starter a couple of years ago, but only played four games last year.
Well, we've seen this a few times from San Jose's offense. Kyle Reed rolling to the right side and then looking back to the middle of the field, finding his wide receiver as the momentum of the defense is going towards the sideline.
Clock is running at 42 seconds. Here comes the blitz. Reed steps up, buying some time, throws it. Clock will stop. No, they're going to keep it going. Jeff Clark has the reception as the clock goes inside of 25 seconds.
Why was the clock not stopped there?
I don't know. He was clearly out of bounds. And San Jose State burns their second timeout. They have one left. Nebraska also with one, and Dick Tomey's going to talk to his troops about it. Now, there are probably a lot of Nebraska fans watching right now that are saying this 30 minutes is horrendous. It's awful. We've given up 215 yards. We have half of that. What would you say if you were running in the locker room now and you knew people? What would you say to these Nebraska fans?
Well, I'd say, first of all, to be patient, you know, and this is a long football game, and you're still up 5 points here, and it might not be for much longer. But that, hey, you know, we're going to be a resilient football team, and we're going to come out in the second half, make adjustments. You know, I think that was one thing that had frustrated Nebraska fans a year ago, was in-game adjustments and maybe the lack of that. And so we'll see what Bo Pelini does with his staff, what they do at halftime here to go in and make adjustments on both sides of the football. Because right, as you can see, you know, with Nebraska's offense struggling and Nebraska's defense giving up a lot of yards, they're going to have to adjust here at half.
They're down and short, 25 left. They'll get the first down. That'll stop the clock with 22.
One timeout remaining for San Jose State.
Coming up at halftime, just a reminder, we're going to be talking to the head basketball coach of the Nebraska Cornhuskers, Doc Sadler. Eric Crouch will be with us and tell us how good Matt Davison really was, along with highlights of analysis of Matt's career, which will be about 10 seconds.
Is that right? No, yeah, it won't take long.
First and 10, ball's on the 19-yard line. Reed looks, caught. That's not going to do a whole lot. They may have to burn the first down or burn another timeout as Richmond makes the reception at the 15. Armando Murillo didn't play last week on the stop, and they will burn their final timeout. Now, if you're Dick Tomey, do you go ahead and try to kick the field? Well, you have to with 4 seconds.
They let some time run off there, Ron. After they got the first down, they didn't get back to the line of scrimmage very fast, and they let some time run off before they snap the football. And now only 4 seconds, so yes, now you have to kick it. You try to go in 14-12 with missing an extra point and a field goal in the first half.
Yeah, well, you know, if I'm Dick, and I'm sure he's probably going to talk to his assistants and his players about this, clock management is so important, and they didn't really have that. You can see him talking to his offensive coordinator, co-offensive coordinator, Steve Morton. There's Bo Pelini, and I'm anxious to see what he tells his troops at halftime. Right now, Jared Strubik, who's already hit from 41 yards out, is going to be in. This is a guy that really struggled last week.
Bo Pelini, right before going to the sidelines, told a couple guys out there to watch for the fake.
This is from the 32-yard line. Philip Zavala, the punter, is holding.
Snap, kick is up, and it is no good. The second field goal missed today, the third miss by Strubik this year. And that's the way the half will end. How disappointing for San Jose State, looking at it again. Good snap, good hold, and this one doesn't bend.
Two of them have hit the upright here in the first half. And Nebraska only had 10 guys on the field there, Ron.
Well, let's send it down. Joel standing by with Coach Pelini.
All right, Ron, thanks a lot. Joined right now by Coach Pelini, and you guys are up on the scoreboard, but they're putting up a lot of offense. What do you say to your kids?
Well, we just had a sloppy first half on both sides of the football. We'll get it fixed.
Looked like over there, though, guys were fairly calm, fairly confident. What are your thoughts going into the second half?
Well, I feel good about what we're doing. We missed a lot of tackles. It was sloppy. Sloppy on both sides of the football, and like I said, we'll get it fixed.
All right, thanks, Coach. That's Coach Pelini. Let's go back upstairs to you guys.
All right, Joel, thanks so much. It's been an interesting first half. Yes, San Jose State hanging around like a bad cold. 14-9, Nebraska leads it. Halftime activities. We'll be talking with Doc Sadler coming up in just a couple of minutes. Stay with us.
In Nebraska Memorial Stadium, where Nebraska leads San Jose State here at the halftime, 14-9. Matt Davison here in the booth, and it is football season, but basketball just around the corner, and I'm glad to be joined by head basketball coach for Nebraska, Doc Sadler. And Coach, thanks for joining us in the booth here. Football Saturdays are big for you too when it comes to recruiting. What's a day like for you during a Nebraska football game?
Well, Matt, probably one of the biggest positives we have here as far as recruiting in all the sports is Saturday football. I mean, I can't imagine there being a place in the country that can do the things that we can do, and it's just a great atmosphere to bring kids into.
Well, you're getting ready to get geared up here for practice here in about a month. What are you doing right now this time of year with your guys before practice starts in October? What are you working on right now?
Well, the thing that the rules allow us to do is spend 2 hours a week with our players, four at a time until next week. So we're just getting a lot of shooting in. This basketball team, as you well know, may not have the size that we've had in the last 2 years, but I do think that one of our strengths is going to be shooting the basketball. The lines move back a little bit, so we're just spending a lot of time shooting the basketball.
Alex Marich is no longer with the program. He was a staple of things here at Nebraska for a long time, but you do have some guys back, Adedog Enduro, Steve Harley. Talk a little bit about your squad and what you expect out of them this year.
Well, again, you mentioned it, and I had forgot that Alex isn't going to be back. But, no, at the same time, I really like our guards. I think, every basketball team has a strength, and I think this season it's going to be our guards. I think the last 10 ball games when we were playing our best, that's when Aday and Steve finally got into a little rhythm. And then Cookie and Sack, we got some new guys coming into it. So I really feel good about our guards, and I like our basketball team.
What about the new faces that Nebraska fans are going to see this year, not just from incoming freshmen, but from guys that redshirted a year ago? What can they expect from these guys?
Well, we had four guys sitting out, and, we do have one incoming freshman, Ishante Jones, that's a perimeter player. But most importantly, it's just going to bring some depth. We're going to play 94 feet this year. We're going to try to pick up defensively and try to get down there as quick as we can offensively. So a lot of guys are going to get to play. And I think that they deserve to play, and they're going to get the opportunity to.
Well, Coach, anybody that's watched any of your teams play knows that they're going to play hard. So we look forward to basketball season this year. Great luck, and thanks for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me, Matt.
That'll do it with Doc Sadler here in the booth as we see the Nebraska band playing out there at halftime, where Nebraska leads San Jose State 14-9. We'll be back with more after this.
Former Huskers quarterback Eric Crouch, as the Huskers are winning here, but a close game. Eric, first off, good to see you back. You're living here now full-time after playing football in Toronto. What's it like to be back here living here?
Well, it's very nice to be around all the fans again and the people of Nebraska. They've been so great helped the football team and this university for so many years. So it's just, it's nice to be back and, you know, be back around family and friends and people that enjoy the football games like this. You really can't beat this.
You've had a chance to play a lot of football after Nebraska. Is there anything like a Saturday in Lincoln?
You know, not since I've left. That's the thing. You know, the tunnel walked, you know, the everybody dressed in red, the atmosphere before the games, and just the support that you get. I mean, you just don't find that outside of Lincoln.
So what are your impressions of this team? A little bit of a rough first half, but new era beginning with Bo Pelini.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that Coach Pelini and all the coaches that he's brought back in this system, a lot of guys that are well-respected in the coaching industry and well-respected here at the university for what they've done in the past. And so I think that that's a good move, bringing people back and bringing back some of the tradition here at Nebraska. And, you know, they've got a win already under their belt. They're on their way to another one here, and that's what it's all about. It's about winning. I mean, no matter how you get it done, may look ugly sometimes. There are many games where we, you know, squeaked a few out. So we just got to continue. You got to find a way to win in the end.
You talk about bringing back tradition. Maybe it all starts with Tom Osborne. What does it mean to have him back here?
It's fantastic. I think a lot of people, everybody that I've talked to, so happy to have him back here. The players included, past players, people of the university, people of the state. I think all of college football is really excited to have Coach Osborne back. He's just one of those stand-up guys. You know, he's a legacy here at Nebraska, always will be. And more importantly, he's a great person. I think the people respect having a great person around here in Nebraska.
They were saying up in the booth that you could do the life and times of Matt Davison. Is that a short story or a long story?
A very long story.
He thought it'd be short. You're going with the long. Sounds good, Eric. Great to see you.
Very long and very short. I really look at it.
One or the other. Thanks a lot, Eric.
You bet. Thanks for having me.
All right, that is Eric Crouch back here in Lincoln and living here full time. Huskers are up 14-9. We're back from Memorial Stadium after this on FSN.
San Jose State doing everything they possibly can to hang around in this ball game. They've already left 7 points on the field, just like they did last week. Now, for Nebraska fans, we talked about it earlier. Right now, as a player, you're in the locker room. Nebraska fans are going, oh my goodness, what is going on? As a player, you've been in this situation. What's it like in the locker room?
Well, this is where your team's character is really challenged right now, and leaders really have to show up. When they're in the locker room right now and you're having a bit of a difficult half, and you're going into a second half against a team that has confidence now in San Jose State, it's your leaders in the locker room. It can't be the coaches. It has to be your players telling each other, your peers, hey, let's stick together. Let's go out and win this thing. And, yeah, you have to have your coach leading you, but really it's the players that have to lead each other in this situation.
Well, I think one surprise is the San Jose State defense. Dick Tomey telling us on Wednesday they are good, but he really kind of focused his praise on the cornerbacks. But everybody has played quite well today for this defense.
Well, their defense has played extremely well. A Nebraska offense that has been potent since Joe Gans took over the starting quarterback last season. And he was taken to the ground 3 times behind the line of scrimmage for sacks. Joe Gans wasn't able to get out of the pocket and use his feet to make plays downfield. So San Jose State did a good job in coverage downfield and also in contain when chasing Joe Gans down in the backfield. So really, all overall, just a stingy effort there for San Jose State in the first half.
Well, you talked about the missed opportunities for the Spartans of San Jose State. The kicking game. Dick Tomey may not have any hair when he goes back to San Jose State after this one.
Well, you come on the road and it's difficult enough to try to play with a team like Nebraska, but you have opportunities to get points on the board and you miss. An extra point goes off the upright. A field goal hits the upright as well, and then another missed field goal. So 7 points with 2 different kickers, and you could have the lead right now. Instead, you're trailing by 5. That's the downside. The upside is you're right in the middle of this football game, only down 5 points on the road at Nebraska.
Once again, it may be a battle of attrition. We're going to find out about that. But when we come back, we'll show you some of the numbers and the highlights from the first 30 minutes of play. We'll return to Nebraska right after this. Both teams have come back onto the field. We are moments away from the second half kickoff. Nebraska leading at 14-9. We don't want to jinx anybody, but if you go back a year ago, Nebraska was in a dogfight with Ball State, and it came down to a couple of key plays. Ball State obviously takes the lead, and Nebraska coming back.
Sam Keller was able to find Maurice Purify. Late in the game, Nate Davis rolls back for Ball State and finds Dante Love, who had a huge game for Ball State. Hits him in the head, would have been a touchdown, might have won the game for Ball State. Then they miss a last second field goal that would have won it for Ball State. And you saw Ball State on TV last night.
Yep.
Nate Davis is a player, but they came in here last year and nearly upset Nebraska. And we said Dante Love had a chance. Hit him right in the head.
There were a lot of people that were upset that Dick Tomey of San Jose State said, I don't want to go to Tennessee. I'd rather play here. I think we can beat these guys. And a lot of people were upset. But, you know, I mean, coaches have a lot of coach speak, but Dick may not believe that, actually.
Well, you have to show your players that you think you can go in there and win for sure.
There are the numbers of the respective quarterbacks, 114 yards throwing. Joe, only 89, 38-13 rushing. And San Jose State's going to get the football to begin the second half. It's going to be Josh Harrison on the far side. And on the near side, Brandon Rutley. So they're going with a lot of different return men. And there you see Reed on the sideline.
And I think it's important for Nebraska to pin San Jose State down on this first possession in the second half.
It's going to be Rutley. As the sun breaks out, he breaks through. Penalty flag thrown over the 50-yard line. And Alec is the one who kind of shoved it, but I think there's a block in the back down at about the 42.
And Nebraska fans are saying, thank God.
Yeah.
That would have been down inside Nebraska territory, inside the 40 of Nebraska. Instead, it's going to come all the way back, probably near the 30-yard line.
How do you usually?
San Jose State.
During the return, number 89. It'll be a 10-yard penalty, first and 10.
Brian Ellidge is the culprit. So he costs his team a lot of yards, probably about 30 yards. And they're going to back this one up, look at it again.
See if we can see it. Right there was the hold, and it was on a double team. Well, that's a tough one to swallow as a coaching staff. You have a double team on a guy, and you still get called for holding.
Well, now the crowd a little antsy here at Memorial Stadium. Over 84,000. Giannis Davis in the backfield with Kyle Reed. And that's going to be a procedure penalty. That is our fourth procedure penalty. Three against the Huskers, one against San Jose State. I guess you can say that's our
dead
special
ball
of the day.
False start. Number nine.
Well, both of these teams have a lot of guys that hadn't played a lot of snaps.
That's right.
And especially at the offensive line for both of these teams, some new faces and younger guys. And sometimes early in the season, that's what you see.
Mm-hmm. Richmond just didn't get set. Sets him back five more, so it's first and 15 from the 27. Reed, the quick out, pass caught. Jurevich up over the 35-yard line. They'll mark him out at the 36-yard line. That'll be a pickup of 9 on the play.
Really too easy.
On the stop.
Easy pass and catch. Al Reed just gets the ball out of the shotgun, turns to his right. See that strong arm there. And Jurevich with a little stop route. Marillo was playing off. An easy pitch and catch for 9 yards.
Well, it makes it a little more manageable now. It's second down and 6. A little flip to Richmond. He's got some running room. Gets the first down up over the 45 to the 47-yard line. A nice job by Ty Steinkuhler. His engine is running because he goes from one side of the field to the other.
In the defensive line position, you always want to follow the play and never quit till the man's down. Steinkuhler there ends up making the play all the way at the sideline.
And again, no huddle, so Nebraska quickly lining up on defense. See it again, just that little shuttle.
It's what they call a jet motion. Jet motions, you're going across the field. You have all that momentum when you get the football.
And Jurevich goes into the backfield. Fake to Davis, pass to Jurevich. Trying to get that corner, and he's going to be chased out of bounds. Scampers close to the 48-yard line by Phillip Dillard. Pickup of only 1 on the play. Second down and 9.
Just so hard to defend when you have guys that can run laterally so fast. And you have a quarterback who can beat you right up the middle. And when you fake it to one back up the middle and then you have speed to the outside, you freeze those backers just enough. And they just need a little alley to get upfield. That's where we've seen them be effective today.
Now, 3 down linemen for Nebraska, 5 wide receivers for San Jose State. And Nebraska only brings 3.5. Passes tip knocked away at the line of scrimmage. Ndamukong Suh again. He's got an interception. Got the big paw up on a 6'4 frame. Swats that one away.
Well, his defensive linemen Obviously, you want to get to the quarterback, but worst case scenario, you don't get there. You get your hands up. That's a nice play. Kyle Reed, not a small quarterback in the pocket.
No. Third down, we'll call it 9. They're 3 of 6 this afternoon. The crowd is again loud. Here Allen all over the place on the line.
Once again, 9 guys near the line of scrimmage.
Here comes 6. Reed throws this up for grabs. Almost picked off by Matt O'Hanlon. Had the hand on it, but Reed is leveled at about the 37-yard line, and he's going to have to get helped up by Bradus McGriff.
Nebraska brought pressure on 3rd and long. They weren't going to let Reed stand back there and pick them apart. They bring pressure off the edge. Watch Cody Glenn on the right side of the screen. Bam!
And you heard the crowd go, ooh, as they replayed it. And I think Kyle Reed hears a phone ringing. He just doesn't know where the phone is right now. Niles Paul now back to get the punt. He's standing on his own 15-yard line. Good snap. Here comes some pressure. Kitchener gets it away, and Paul at the 15. That's where he's going to take a seat.
Nice coverage from San Jose State. Nebraska will take over about the 10-yard line.
Let's take a look at those first half possessions. First of all, for Nebraska, see what they've done. They punted their first, turned it over their next two, punted their next two, and then the interception.
Not what you're looking for out of this offense. Joe Gans, I expect him to be much sharper here in the second half. I'm sure Sean Watson got together with his QB, and they made some adjustments for sure.
Well, one of the reasons he hasn't run a lot, they haven't been in that cover two, which is what they were hoping these guys would go in. As Lucky gets stacked up at the line of scrimmage, may have picked up a half a yard. Demetrius Chapman coming up, the senior out of San Diego, California, Mission Bay High School. Does it get frustrating when you can't run the football?
Well, I think so, because you know, you're telling your guys all week, we want to be physical, we want to be physical. And bottom line right there was Nebraska didn't have enough guys to block that side of the line when Chapman came. Everyone seemed to be locked up pretty well on a little zone block on the right side, and Chapman came off the edge.
And what they wanted to do, San Jose State on defense, is get more people at the point of attack than Nebraska can block, and they've done that this far. Oh, my, that's a completion at the 20-yard line. Let's see what the officials are all looking at each other. Now they're saying incomplete. One official ruled a completion, 2 weren't sure.
We're going to find out. This is a crazy-looking play. Should have been an incompletion there, it looks like.
They hit the ground.
They did hit the ground. Mike McNeil, he couldn't come up with it, threw it back over his head, just the momentum.
Yeah.
Kind of catapulted the ball behind him. And Peterson was somehow able to corral it. It would have been a first down, I think, for Nebraska.
Don't you hate when these receivers get these deflections and make good plays?
Yeah.
They become stars, don't they, Matt?
Be in the right spot, the right time.
I call that experience, right? That was a heads-up play by Peterson. We're going to have a timeout on the field. I think San Jose State has called the timeout. The officials now are still talking things over. We'll step aside, come back. Nebraska leads it by 5.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions, the nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
Who has the power to increase the odds of surviving this? Or this? University of Nebraska Lincoln Research found the solution. Our energy-absorbing, safer barriers bounce back, save lives. Inspired research powered by Nebraska. It's technology on the way to a highway near you. That's the power of red.
If you left us at halftime, you haven't missed anything, because the score remains the same, 14-9, with just under 13 minutes to play. Husker fans catch Big 12 football on FSN all season long.
FSN will televise 19 games live and in HD on Big 12 Showcase. We preview the week's games. And on Saturdays throughout the fall, watch FSN's Big 12 postgame shows for all the highlights. Plus, catch the Bo Pelini Show on Tuesdays at noon. Big 12 football this fall on FSN. Third down and 10. Ball is sitting on the 10-yard line for the Huskers.
What you're seeing from San Jose State, Ron, is they're lining up with pretty much a base defense, but they're always bringing someone. They have people around the line of scrimmage. You see Chapman, they're cheating up from the bottom of the screen, and don't be surprised if he comes again in coverage here.
They twisted the line of scrimmage. Gans has some running room, could get the first down, and he's going to be short by about a half a yard. But one of the officials is marking it at the 20, and San Jose State does not like that spot. Oh, they're putting him over the 20.
Wow. Great effort from Joe Gans. Uses his legs. Gets upfield.
Oh, I guess he rolled over the guy.
He rolled over the top of the guy. And what a fortunate play for Nebraska. I mean, that could have, should have been easily a punting situation for Nebraska.
Now Peterson goes in motion. Fresh set of downs for the Huskers. They'll try the running game again. Lucky gets about three. We've got a penalty, another procedure penalty. That'll be the fourth procedure penalty on Nebraska, and that'll be should be their seventh penalty overall.
Offside.
Oh, offside.
Defense, number 17.
Oh.
I thought they called it on the motion man there, Ron.
I thought so, too.
So a little five-yard gift from San Jose State. And you know, just a couple plays here and there change football games. Nebraska
That's
has
right.
the lead because of a touchdown, a pick on defense. And run back for a touchdown by Sue. And on this drive, they get the nice spot on the effort from Joe Gans, and now they're driving.
Well, first down and five. Castile now in the backfield. They continue to rotate backs. Quick pass, caught. Swift gets the corner up over the 30-yard line. They'll mark him out at the 33-yard line. First and 10 Huskers. Christopher Owens on the coverage, the senior out of Dorsey High School in Los Angeles. For Swift, that's his fourth catch of the afternoon.
Just a little screen out to the outside. You try to get a receiver out blocking in front of you. Big Todd Peterson out there in front of Swift. Executed well, and another first down.
And now Will Henry goes wide to the right. Quentin Castile in the backfield. Miles Paul near side, or in the slot. Given off to Castile, and he is stacked up at the 35-yard line. Picked up two on the play. Now, there are a lot of close games going on in college football right now. None closer than this is Ohio State just has taken the lead early in the fourth quarter over Frank Solich and Ohio University 19-14. Frankie actually led 14-12. They had a chance to receive a punt. They fumbled it, and Ohio State took it in for a score.
And just like that, they're down 5 points in the fourth quarter, but great effort there from Frank Solich and Ohio.
Oh, met right in the backfield is Castile, and he is going to get back to the line of scrimmage. How, I don't know. That'll bring up a third down. We'll call it age of Schwager. Well, listen to this. This is a pop and a half here.
Two big men running into each other.
Oh, my.
Bam. And Nebraska's running game just has not gotten going.
No.
You know, they're trying, and they're trying that right side a lot, it seems. But nowhere to go.
Only 34 yards rushing in this game for the Huskers. Hold on the near side, Peterson on the far side on third down. Pressure from up the middle. Dumps the pass off short of the first down, the Mental League hold. He is going to get up to about the 39-yard line. He needed to get up to the 43-yard line. Coy Francis on the coverage.
And that was a great tackle by Francis in the open field. San Jose State brought pressure there. Joe Gans was able to have time because Nebraska's offensive line picked up the blitz. Holt was able to catch it, but if Francis doesn't make the hit, he just stood Holt up right there. He's not a small wide receiver, Holt out there at 6'4 and 220. Nice open field tackle to force the punt.
10 men on the line of scrimmage for San Jose State. Jurevich back to receive this kick, and it's a good one. Fair catch is being called for. Jurevich is going to let it bounce, and it'll take a San Jose State bounce up to the 32-yard line. Cody Glenn finally downing the ball. So that's where San Jose State will take over. First down and 10. We've got 9 minutes and 29 seconds left to play in quarter number 3. Nebraska leads it by 5.
14-9 in the third quarter. Nebraska leading San Jose State at Memorial Stadium. Welcome back, Joel Goldberg, down on the field and really by the crowd here. And everybody's still here, plenty of red, but with the 14-9 score, not a ton of grumbling, but not a lot of noise as well. Look at this. Everybody just kind of sitting. You hear a couple defenses there, but they are quiet, waiting to erupt and doing so patiently. Guys, let's go back upstairs to you.
All right, couple of defensive changes. Prince Amakamara is going to come in for Armando Murillo. Of course, Murillo did not play last week because of the back spasms. Also, Major Colbert's now coming at the strong safety spot. Couple of changes, but San Jose State takes over. First and 10, ball's on the 32-yard line, 9:29 to play in the third. Obviously, Reed shook off that tough hit by Cody Glenn a few moments ago. He's back in the game. Davis running up ahead over the 35-yard line, up to the 37-yard line. He'll pick up about 5 on the play. Pierre Allen on the stop. Defensive changes. Should we read anything into that?
You know, I don't think so, because Amukamara played so much last week, started at corner, and he's usually the nickel guy. So now Hague is in as the fifth defensive back, and Colbert there. I'm a little surprised Asante is out of the game, and they went with Colbert and O'Hanlon, but
right.
You know, Nebraska's defense, I mean, really has only given up, you know, 9 points, so it's not like they've been horrible today, even though they've given up some yards.
There's a little razzle and a little dazzle. Jurevich, no place to go. Nice job, Cody Glenn. It's like he read the play from the beginning. That was great effort.
Well, that's staying home right there, as everybody was going left with the offense towards the top of the screen. And a little reverse coming back, and Cody Glenn stays home.
Yeah.
And Jurevich is not an easy man to tackle out in the open field. Cody Glenn shows that athleticism, stays with it, and is able to get him out of bounds.
Well, they want to get their best athletes on the field at San Jose State. Now they're facing third down and a long 4. Now the crowd is alive. Reed, pass caught up over the 40 to the 42-yard line. That'll be good enough for the first down. Jurevich did a nice job knowing where that yard line marker was, because when he made the catch, he was short. Matt, how tough is that to be aware that you still need a yard or two?
Well, you're lucky that you have those orange things laying over there. I don't know what you call those exactly. You could sometimes see the stick. But they lay down the orange marker there, so you know where you have to get to. And Jurevich did a nice job with his feet at getting that extra yard.
Third catch for him. Whoa, Davis almost lost it. That handoff from Reed to Davis was dicey at best. I take that was Rutley. That was close to a fumble.
Like Pierre Allen was able to get into the backfield. You're right, he barely got it there to Rutley. Not a clean exchange right here. Whoops. Ty Steinkuhler and Pierre Allen there to make a play.
A loss of 3 on the play. Second down and 13 now. And Nebraska's showing blitz. They only bring 3. Delayed blitz. Pass is complete. Close to the 48-yard line. Terrence Williams on the reception. That's Williams' second catch of the evening.
Quick slant there to the outside on the right side with loose coverage. You run a quick slant, able to catch it. Nice gainer, brings up third and short.
Now the crowd starting to get back into it. Rutley back in the backfield, next to Reed. Only 2 deep covers for Nebraska. 9 on the line of scrimmage, they bring 7. Reed tries to juke, doesn't get close to the line of scrimmage, as Zach Potter nails him down.
Potter made the tackle, but Major Colbert is who really made Kyle Reed get upfield and ran him right into Potter. Little misdirection, faked the handoff. Kyle Reed goes around the outside with that great speed, but Colbert really comes upfield hard. Makes Kyle Reed, forces him right into Potter. Potter made the play, and now a punt from San Jose State. So a big defensive stand there. San Jose State had another chance to take the lead if they get into the end zone.
Zavala's kick, averaging 39, his first 2.
Swift back at the 15, didn't call a fair catch. Gets by the first wave, still on his feet, up to the 23-yard line, a return of 8. Travis Jones on the stop. 6:05 left to play in the third quarter. Decent field position for the Huskers. Do you think you scrap the run now? Do you just say, forget it, we haven't done a whole lot, we've only rushed for 34 yards, averaging 2 yards a carry, heck with it. Let's go upstairs.
Well, it wouldn't surprise me, and I think you want to get Joe Gans out in the open field. Maybe it's a bootleg, maybe it's a sprint out, something to let him, give him an option of run or pass.
Let's check in with Joel on the sidelines. Joel.
Well, Ron, as the offense comes out, they will do so with an offensive line led by Mike Huff, among others. The guard has played 20 games as a starter here at Nebraska. A lot of experience, also graduated. He's now working on his graduate work, getting some of those classes in. Talked to his former high school coach at Ralston High, Tyler Zahn, this week, who still coaching there as a former Husker. He said that Tyler's the same now as he was then, a superhuman being, a grinder, a guy that gives you all that he's got in the classroom, the weight room, and on the field. They'll need his leadership now as they try to put some points on the board, guys.
That's a great story. You're absolutely right. You know, Huff, you look at him, the senior out of Ralston, he is kind of overlooked because everybody talks about the other linemen. He was a right tackle last year. He had to overcome an Achilles injury. He's already graduated. This guy's stout.
Well, he is, and he's a, you know, right here in Nebraska, so grew up watching Nebraska football. You know, this really means something to him to wear that jersey, put on that helmet. And those are the offensive linemen you like. You know, those right. Big, burly guys that are 300 pounds. They're kind of big softies off the field. Nice, you know, superhuman beings, great character, but they get out there and they're just dirty and mean and like to tear it up in the trenches. Mike Huff is one of those guys.
Well, Joe Gans, over 100 yards today, 101, puts him at over 2,000 for his career yards, throwing the football, 16th Nebraska quarterback to accomplish that. Now we got Hello and Castile in. They call this the rocket package. Gillian also in. Still try it on the ground with Hello. Gets up close to the 25-yard line. That'll be a pickup of 3 on the play. Nebraska continuing to shuttle in tight ends.
So there was a little bit of a wrinkle having two backs in the backfield, one not being a fullback, two I-backs back there.
We saw it a little bit last week with Lucky and Castillo. Once again, Bo Bellini wants Sean Watson to kind of keep rotating these backs in. Now it's just Hello by himself. Little jumbo package. Now McNeil goes in motion. The pitch back to Hello. Looks for the outside block. Penalty flag is thrown at about the 35-yard line. He gets up to the 32. That'll be about, looks half a yard short of the first down.
I think that's going to be an illegal block below the waist on Nebraska. Penalty flag in play.
That'll be the 7th penalty against the Huskers if it is against them. And Crystal making sure.
When you're coming from outside in, you have to stay above the waist when you're blocking. And I think you might see Mike McNeil come into the screen once we get the call here, and we'll see the replay. You have to stay above the waist. You have to protect right. Those defenders.
Buck below the waist, number 44, half the distance to the goal.
And that's exactly, a big one, too.
That's exactly what it was. You'll see, watch Mike McNeil on the left side of the screen there, and you see it right there below the waist. You take out a knee, you flip a guy, and it maybe doesn't look bad there, but when a guy isn't looking and all the flow is going one way, you coming from outside in, you have to stay above the waist.
All right, Hello is back in the backfield again. Second down and long. Gans has some time, throws into the flat, passes complete to Hello, and he gets up to the 17-yard line. They're going to mark it at the 19-yard line. Justin Cole on the coverage. There's Sean Watson, the outstanding offensive coordinator. Here's a guy that Alabama really wanted. They dangled a lot in front of him. And when I asked him last week, I said, Sean, you know, I've known you for a while, going back to your days at Colorado. Why would you not take that? He says, because I made a commitment to the players and Tom Osborne. And that's what he's fighting there, the play clock. He said he was kind of surprised how fast it went last week. Little delayed snap. Everybody's standing around. Gans fakes the pass and then tucks it. That was, I think you'd call that a bad play.
Well, not everybody, I don't think, was on the same page when it came to the snap count. Some of the offensive linemen seemed shocked by the snap count. The ball was snapped, and defensive linemen came flying through the line of scrimmage. And for Joe Gans just to get it out of the pocket and get back to the line of scrimmage was a lot there. So another play with miscommunication, I think, there, Ron.
Well, Jurevich now standing up at his 43-yard line. Titchener back at his 5. Boy, I tell you, this crowd is on their, sitting on their hands right now. That's a line drive kick. San Jose State could get good field position. Jurevich gets into Nebraska territory down to the 45. As a player, do you know that how quiet it is? Because we're sitting here, we're thinking, there's no energy in this stadium right now. Notice it as a player?
This is as quiet as I've ever seen it in here. Well, there may be a couple times last year where I saw it pretty quiet.
Yeah, right.
But you know what? As a player, you sit over there and you say, we have to give them something to cheer about. I mean, if you're in the stadium right now,
right,
what are you going to cheer about? And Domokong Su runs a touchdown back on an interception, and
right,
they cheer loud. You have to give them something to cheer for. Right now, our players aren't getting that done.
5 wide receivers. Nebraska brings 4. They swing it out to the far side to Davis. Nice little hesitation move. It'll be a yard short of the first down. Dillard pushes him out of bounds at about the 36.
We'll see here on this screen play to the outside, Major Colbert coming right there, and there's a cut block that I think potentially could have been called from the
yeah.
He was outside coming inside on Major Colbert and cut him. And that's one of those iffy calls right there in the open field.
Second down and short for Kyle Reed. He's just going to keep it straight ahead running. He's got the first down. Leans inside the 35, down about the 33. Joel, what do you have for us?
Well, you know, Matt was just talking about needing something to get excited about. I found a group that is really excited, and it's the San Jose defense. They are on the sidelines meeting right now, and lots of high fives, lots of let's go, let's keep on doing it, and a lot of screaming and yelling. That is a group that is absolutely fired up and has a lot of momentum, so the Huskers will need to find a way to quiet them down.
Absolutely. That's a good call on that because, you know, these guys, you never want to keep teams that you should blow out close. He keeps it again, down to the 30-yard line. Pickup of 3, Ty Steinkuhler around the stop. Reed, 146 yards passing today. 16 of 23. He's also been fairly effective running the football, as he's close to 45 yards.
He's been very efficient today. And you know, it's hard to believe he was the third guy in last week.
I know. What were they thinking?
What do they have in front of him? I mean, they had a couple pretty good quarterbacks in front of him, evidently, or they just missed. And Kyle Reed is a gamer and not a practice
guy. That's right. They're closing in on 300 total yards, and everybody's jumping up on the line. I love how everybody points to each other. You did it. No, you did it.
All start.
It's like a bunch of little kids.
Offense, number 71, 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Well, Nathaniel Timo, who was replaced in the starting lineup by Fred Coloto, is the one who moved. Timo, the junior out of Seaside, California, Monterey Peninsula College.
Right side of the screen, left guard, moved just a little bit. The right foot, that's going to do it. 5 yards, now you're in second and 12, much different than second and medium with second
yeah.
and 7.
2 minutes and 19 seconds left in the third, and now Nebraska is going to call the timeout.
Well, we've seen this a lot the first couple of weeks where Bo Pelini uses a timeout on defense because he knows when his defense is in a situation where if they don't make the right check, it
right.
could potentially be a big play down the field. You know, he studied film of San Jose State.
Mm-hmm.
He's seen different sets, the way they line up, personnel they have on the field. And right there he said, what we have on the field and what we have called isn't going to match up with this play. Boom, timeout. That's, as a head coach, you have the ability to use that
That's
timeout.
Right.
Where if you're just a defensive coordinator, I don't know if you get that luxury from the head coach to be able to say, I call timeout whenever I want.
That's right. And now they're down to one timeout.
Left in the game in a tight game.
Well, you know, one of the things getting Bo Pelini back in the mix was one thing, but getting Dr. Tom Osborne back in the mix is a totally different thing. And Josh Brown said that was important. The former Husker likes it.
It's hard to describe what that's like to probably everybody in the state of Nebraska and in that
back on Osborne Field. But to have him back, I think, is a big sigh of relief. A big wave of peace goes over a lot of people because, I mean, there's so much trust in Coach Osborne. I mean, he did a great job for a long time, and I'm sure that eased a lot of nerves.
Well, what eased a lot of nerves is putting up a good defensive stand when the play did not develop quickly. That was a slow developing play. It looked like Richmond didn't want the football. That brings up a third down and long.
Came around the backside of the formation, and you're right. It just seemed like everyone wasn't on the same page there. Like he was surprised he pitched it.
It was. That's what I thought, too. Now Rutley is back. Third down and 15. Now the crowd into it. Almost picked off again by Pierre Allen. The third pass knocked down today. Sue's got one for the touchdown. Pierre Allen getting the hand up.
Little jailbreak screen to the right side. Pierre Allen was flowing out there. He sees he's a rush in, but he's taking an angle around the tackle. Almost playing off the line of scrimmage and gets that hand up, knocks it down.
And Nate Swift is back because facing third down, fourth down at 15, San Jose State will kick it away. Zavala at his 48. Wants to get this inside the 20, gets a wobbly kick, and at the 13-yard line, that's where it will be down.
And Nebraska really needs to flip the field, Ron.
You're right.
Even if they don't go down and score, how many times have we seen it this half? Nebraska hasn't even made it outside of their 20-yard line, starting at the 10-yard line, one time starting at the 17-yard line, another, and now at the 14. So field position definitely in favor of San Jose State, and they just haven't been able to get a couple first downs to flip the field, I guess, on San Jose State.
Great point, because it seems like this whole second half they've been in their own territory.
It's amazing the mental difference between starting at your own 10 or 15-yard line and starting out at your 35 or 40-yard line.
Well, now they're going to go with a four-wide wide receiver set, two on the left, two on the right. They get it to Swift. Gets a block from Peterson. Up to the 25, maybe the 26-yard line. That'll be a first down. Nice job, though, by Todd Peterson. And talking to the coaches, one of the things they were extremely happy about, the blocking of the wide receiver, something that Coach Brown stressed when you were here, Matt.
Yeah, and he's such a big man, you know, out there. Todd Peterson at 6'4", 215 pounds. You know, he's able to get out in front and block, and he did a great job there. Nice play call. I like that one from Sean Watson.
Loosen things up a little bit. Now they swing it out again to Swift. Gets another block, and he gets another first down. Same play. It's like, okay, it worked this time. Let's try it again.
And they're going to make San Jose State, you know, adjust there on defense. Another short route here, and, hey, we'll block him with Peterson. We like that matchup. And then we'll let Nate Swift out in the open field make a move and get another first down. But these are short passes. We haven't seen Joe Gans go up top much.
Right.
You know, we saw big chunks of yardage last week against Western Michigan in the pocket, outside of the pocket. Nebraska hasn't been able to do that here. Let's see if they challenge him down the middle of the football field here sometime soon.
We'll mix it up, try to keep it on the ground this time, and Hello gets through. And he jumps up close to the 50-yard line. That'll be close to another first down. He blew a tire while he was doing that. Duke Iannaccio, the sophomore from Carson, California, with a stop. But another for three consecutive plays, three first downs.
And this is the most success Nebraska's offense has had for sure here in the second half, and probably three straight plays in the entire game. Ran right out of his shoe. That's fast.
This may be the final play of the quarter. Final 20 seconds left. Another first and 10. Quentin Castile now coming in the backfield. Again, that same set with four wide receivers. Gans looks to run the option. Castile got a lot of running room. He lost the football. Still loose, and San Jose State has it. He had a bunch of green in front of him and couldn't get the handle.
And we talked about it earlier in the broadcast here that Joe Gans was going to be able to check to an option play when San Jose State packed the box. And on this particular play, you see all 11 defenders for San Jose State are up near the line of scrimmage. Joe Gans changes the play, runs the option to perfection.
Oh.
And that's a good pitch. You have to make that. You have to catch that ball. Might have been a little bit on the left side of his chest, but you make that catch. if you're Quentin Castile. In a big game, in a close game here at home, you've got to make that play. He fumbles it. San Jose State jumps on top of him.
Second turnover of the ball game for Nebraska. Reed now looking, throwing out a deep into the flat. Pass is caught by David Richmond. Richmond with his fifth reception of the evening. And Reed is down, and he's grabbing his right ankle, kind of hopping up a little bit. But that's going to end the third quarter. Everybody went nowhere quickly in this quarter. We'll head to the final 15 minutes. Nebraska clinging to a 5-point lead. Crowd of over 84,000 is stunned because the Nebraska Cornhuskers that rolled over Western Michigan last week only lead by five as we head to the final stanza. And you take a look at some of the numbers as we head to the final quarter. Right now, San Jose State plus 90 in total yards, and the rushing yards again low. But it was the turnover, because that last possession, it was obvious Nebraska was moving the football. Three consecutive first downs and then the fumble.
Well, they had a little momentum there, and then they have a fumble from Quentin Castile, and San Jose State gets the ball back. They're leading in time of possession. They're leading in total yardage. And maybe the most, maybe the worst part about it all is Nebraska has run 38 plays of offense through three quarters. And San Jose State has run 52 plays of offense. So there you get the time of possession. Nebraska's just never been able to get that drive to really be sustained and put a bunch of plays together.
Let's go down to Joel with an update on the Nebraska sideline. Joel.
Well, had a chance, Ron, to watch the guys as they came off after that turnover. A couple heads down, but for the most part, very positive. A lot of screaming over there, but the coaches, the message was this. We finally got a spark. Let's not give up on it now. Let's build on that. We got something going the last time out. And let's not let the defense do all the work. They're helping us out. Let's do our part as well. Guys like Nate Swift and some of the offensive linemen trying to pump up the team, and they're going to try to go out there and do their part, guys.
All right, thanks, Joel. We begin the final quarter. Nebraska leading by five, San Jose State. Second down and two on the 43-yard line. Reed to Davis. Breaks into the secondary. Inside the 15, they'll mark him down at about the 20-yard line. Inside the 25, I should say, down to the 20.
And there's a flag down on the play. We'll see what it is right at the end of the play. Big hole on the right side for Davis to run through.
Sideline interference, Nebraska, 5-yard penalty.
Once again, that's a rule change. They were really adamant about this, talking to the coaches and the officials. First two are 5 yards, third on is 15.
Yeah. Little read option, gives it to Davis, going through the right side with all that momentum. You see his speed. Hard to see the sideline there. You can't quite see who was interfering.
I didn't see it either, but nevertheless, first and 10 from the 16-yard line. San Jose State trying to take the lead. Reed looks, fires, caught inside the 10 down to the 9-yard line. Let's go back to that previous play and see on the sideline. See exactly. You could be on the white, but he interfered with the official. See?
Yep,
the official ran into him.
That's Bo Pelini, and you know, he was probably upset because they're giving up a big chunk of yards. It's only 5 yards added on to the play, but it is 5 yards, and you know, he was upset about the big gain anyway, and a little too far out onto the field.
Second down and three. Davis again tries that right side, tries to get outside. He may lose a yard on the play. Dominican Sue on the stop. By the way, that sideline rule has been officially tabbed the Mike Stoops rule. Coach at Arizona, because he is notorious for doing that. Now it brings up a third down and three. Ball is on the 9-yard line. Opening minutes of the fourth. Crowd trying to get into this ball game. Three wide receivers to the left.
Huge play here, Ron. Nebraska could force a field goal attempt from San Jose State, and we know how shaky that has been.
Reed just keeps it. He's going to be stopped at the 10-yard line. He's going to lose another yard. That looked again like a broken play. Pierre Allen on the stop. Now you talk about a shaky offensive play. You've already missed a couple of field goals, and Struvik is going to be Struvik again. I think they're bringing Strubik back in.
Strubik back in there, and you know, they ran it over the right side again, which kept him on the right hash.
Yep.
And not that, I mean, I know they were trying to get a first down, but now you have that angle too, and they've struggled so badly with getting the ball through the uprights.
This will be a 27-yarder. Strubik's made one and missed one today. Ball's down, the kick. And he's made two, and the groan you heard was actually Dick Tomey going, finally.
So a drive that gets him down there. And
oh, and they had a golden opportunity after the sideline infraction, and they couldn't take advantage of a good job by the Nebraska defense stepping them up, and it's a two-point ball game, but plenty of time left. Over 300 yards offense, though, for San Jose State. Joe Gans warming up. We've got a timeout on the field. 12:17 to play. Nebraska will have the ball when we come back.
Husker fans, don't miss your chance to be part of the action at the Devaney Center this fall.
Go! A bottle of Don by Doggenbarrow. Highlight reel.
2008-2009 Nebraska men's basketball season ticket packages are on sale now and start at only $99. To get your tickets, visit Huskers.com or call 1-800-8-BIG-RED. Nebraska basketball. Play hard as one. Cheer hard as one.
Reserve your seat at the Lead Center for Performing Arts.
It's been a hard day's life, and I've been working like a dog.
Come on, give it to me.
The Lead Center for Performing Arts. The hottest ticket in town.
14-12, Nebraska's lead cut down to two. 12:17 to play in the ballgame, along with Matt Davis and Joel Goldberg. Ron Thulin coming your way. Next week, of course, New Mexico State comes to the stadium, but the business at hand is this team. You were telling me during the break, as we look at Barry Turner, he's in street clothes, obviously has a walking boot on that left leg. No official confirmation what happened. This is what happened in the first quarter. Dude, just rolled up right there.
Boy, it looks ugly. You hate to speculate about what it could be.
Yeah.
But you just hope it's not one of those deals that lingers on, and you hope he's back as soon as possible. He's a vital part of this Nebraska defensive line.
Absolutely. Just a junior out of Antioch, Texas, Brentwood Academy. Freshman All-American. Now Nebraska will get the football. This is going to be a short kick. Miles Paul. Oh, my. Look out. Needs one block. He doesn't need it. He's going to outrun everybody. Goodbye.
And what a huge.
Yards. That woke up the crowd. You were telling me during the break, this team has got to get a touchdown.
Well, you need a touchdown there to make it another, to make it a two-score game again. And what a huge, huge play by Niles Paul. And you're going to see a big block from Denard out in front of him when you see the replay, because he was the guy leading Niles Paul up the sidelines.
And the extra point, trying to make it 85 consecutive, dating back to 2006. Henry does it. 50 for 50 last year, 7 for 7 this year. First career touchdown, and what an exciting one at that. Let's look at this one again.
Niles Paul with that great speed is able to, once he caught it, find a little alley. And you'll see Denard out in front of him here. He just rides his outside hip. And the kicker there for San Jose State needed to force that play back inside. He didn't. Niles Paul gets to the sideline, and you are not going to catch him with that great 4-3 speed down the sidelines. Biggest play of his Husker career.
Oh, boy. I said he needed a block, and then I looked down and thought, nah.
He doesn't need one.
He doesn't need a block.
Just going to outrun everybody. What a monster play in this game. Nebraska with 21 points, seven of them on an interception return. Touchdown by the defense, it's seven by the special teams. Those are teams that find ways to win these games.
Right.
You know, you're going to be in battles. This is a game everyone thought Nebraska may run away with, but you're going to find yourself in battles throughout the season. Those teams that just find a way to get it done. It might be special teams, might be defensively doing something, coming up with a turnover. Nebraska's found a way today to stay up by 9 points, still a two-score game.
You know, you talk to the great coaches, and everybody, as Ohio State was struggling today with finally beating Frank Solich's Ohio U team, I think they finally won by something like 12. But every team's going to face this adversity, and yes, it's frustrating for the fans, but no more frustrating than it is for that man right there and his assistant coaches. But you do have to find ways to win. But we still have the proverbial plenty of time left, over 12 minutes left to play in this game. But at least the stadium's got some energy now.
And, you know, we've talked about Nebraska's defense has given up yards today. Yes, over 300 yards of offense, but they haven't let San Jose State into the end zone a lot.
Right.
You know, they forced field goals, and they've been tough when San Jose State has gotten down inside the red zone, and they've forced field goals where San Jose State has missed a couple of them. They've made a couple of them. But that's what's kept this game with Nebraska having the lead.
Okay, everybody had their shoes off and holding them up. Is that like give them the boot or something, Matt? All the fans had their shoes off and we just saw it on one of those shots?
I have not seen that.
Okay, good. I don't feel so badly now.
Of course, the last time I sat in the stands in this stadium was about 1996. So I don't know exactly what goes on.
Well, I looked over my main man, Scott, over here, and he kind of looked, had this little smirk on his face, and he tried to explain to me what it was. Now they're doing the X. All right, we talked about this quarterback matchup, which was going to be a good one between Joe Gans, obviously, and Kyle Reed. And right now, Joe Gans has thrown for 130 yards. Reed, 161 yards. Joe Gans minus 2 yards rushing. This is after having a career high rush of 32 yards on one play last week. Can San Jose State answer? A big defensive play will really get this crowd in things. Here comes the blitz. Reed, he's going down.
Phillip Dillard comes on the blitz. He comes around the right side. And Kyle Reed did not see him coming. He didn't read blitz. Once he got out of the pocket, there was Phillip Dillard. Little sprint out to the left side, the formation, and Dillard was right there. Kyle Reed tried to get rid of it, but he just couldn't.
And that's a loss of 12 on the play, and San Jose State's going to burn a timeout. That'll leave them with two. Nebraska has one. And Carl Pelini told us yesterday, he said, listen, we're going to come at these guys. We haven't seen a lot of it. I thought there'd be a lot more, but the timing on this one was perfect. We're going to take a break. 11 minutes and 40 seconds left to play in the ball game. Nebraska's got a little bit of breathing room. 11 minutes and 40 seconds left to play in this contest, and Nebraska leads it by 9, 21-12. Huskers are back at Memorial Stadium next Saturday night to take on New Mexico State. You can watch the game on television via pay-per-view. Call your cable or satellite provider or visit Huskers.com for more information. Once again, we're on the air at 6 p.m. for that ball game, and Hal Mumme's team is promising to be very exciting also. Loss of 12 on that sack, so it sets up a second and 22. Ball is now on the 8-yard line. Kyle Reed is sitting down on the sideline. He is not in at quarterback. Miles Eden's now in, the junior out of Canyon Lake, California.
What a big blow for this offense.
Eden winds up, lets it fly, has a man tipped away. Good defensive play by Murillo. David Richmond, the intended receiver.
It's amazing what a shot of adrenaline you get defensively when the crowd gets into the game. Nebraska's able to run back a kickoff for a touchdown. They get a big defensive play from Phillip Dillard, and that just brought the crowd to life. San Jose State tries to go up top, and a nice play made by Murillo on the far sideline.
221 yards offense for San Jose State in the first half, 73 yards here in the second half. And now they're facing third and 22 with a new quarterback, Miles Eden. They bring four, pressure's on, pass incomplete. A nice hit by Cody Glenn, jarred the ball free for Brandon Rutley. Now that's the Nebraska defense we saw last week.
Absolutely, you feel the energy in this stadium right now, and Cody Glenn was able to read this play. He's out in coverage in the flat. The pass comes, he times it nicely. He's able to go out there and break up the play.
So now they're going to be forced to punt, and this is also a dangerous situation if you're San Jose State. Good snap. Just try to pooch that ball out there. It's off the side of his foot. And Nebraska will get outstanding field position. They'll mark it at the 35-yard line.
So a shank punt after a three and out by the Nebraska defense. And all of a sudden, Nebraska has a 9-point lead and a chance to go in and extend the lead.
There's Kyle Reed, the starting quarterback, who's had a dynamite game. He's been looked at by a number of doctors and trainers on the sideline. We'll look at it again. I can't see what exactly happened. Maybe it's just a compilation of everything that's happened today. Does he go on his head?
Now Zach Potter is a big person.
Gans his pass completed the 25-yard line to Holt. He barrels his way down to the 15-yard line. We talked on the open, Matt, and you made a point that the fact that Joe Gans has that mobility, that's a completely different weapon. That was a great case in point.
And we haven't seen it a lot today, but that was a classic example of that. Get him out of the pocket, give Joe the ability to run or pass. Mentally, Colt, big target downfield, is able to make the catch and get some yards after catch as well.
Swift, Peterson, and Holt now wide to the left. Neal in a tight end on the right side. Keep it on the ground with Hillu. He looks for the corner, has one block. It's inside the 10. Mark him out at about the 8.5. Pick up of about 7 on the play. Sets up a 2nd and short. We talked also, Matt, we made it a point about this battle of attrition that, yes, San Jose State's very, very talented group. They've got some people that can play football, but if it's a rough and tumble game, they cannot match the numbers.
They shouldn't be able to, and you give them credit because they've done a really, really good job of it today, but this is about the time that maybe you start to see him wear down just a little bit.
Heller looks for the first down, stretches the football, will be about 0.5 yards short, close to the 5-yard line. That'll set up a 3rd down situation. Devin Newsom from that safety spot making the stop.
3rd and very short. This is where you need to be able to get that yard when you really need it.
Right.
You need to have that big offensive line. You need to have an attitude as an offense that, hey, this is a huge play in this game, and we need to put 7 points on the board, push everybody forward, and get this 0.5 yard.
Quinton Castile on the top of the eye. He's got the football right side. Got the first down. Gets down to the 4-yard line. Justin Cole stacks him up, and he rolls forward. And I think they're going to mark him down at the 4.
They are, because the whistle was blown when his momentum stopped. Castile didn't quit on the play, and it rolled down to about the 1, but they're going to put it back at the 4. It'll be 1st down. The pulling guard there fell down.
Yeah.
Coming around the end for Nebraska. That was Keith Williams. And still, Castile was able to get the 1st down.
They were 5 for 5 in a red zone last week. We've got a whistle, and a timeout's going to be called by San Jose State. They'll also have 1 timeout left. Boy, they know that Nebraska, once they got the upper hand, that San Jose State said, we don't want this thing to slip away, and if you're Dick Tomey, you need to stop something. But I think it's going to be awfully difficult for them.
It is. I mean, 1st down and goal at the 4-yard line. I think Nebraska would have a pretty good shot of pushing this thing into the end zone, making it a 16-point game at that point, which is still only 2 scores with two two-point conversions. But Nebraska fans could breathe a little easier if they do stick this one in and push it to a 28-12 game.
Well, Bo Pelini's boss, obviously, Tom Osborne, a former politician, and Richie Incognito was asked, do you think it's tougher to be a politician or the head coach at Nebraska?
I think running Nebraska football, I think he has definitely a lot more critics running Nebraska football. He has just as many. He's the whole state of Nebraska, and then you have all the influences outside, all the people that come in, all the fans. But that's a tough job. But, I mean, if anybody could do it, it's him.
I would agree with that.
Well, he's exactly right. Coach Osborne runs for governor, and that doesn't work out. And little did everyone know in Nebraska and Husker fans everywhere that it was actually better. I think
so too.
So he's back running the athletic department, and I think you know, if you ask most Nebraskans, Nebraska fans in general, anywhere, it's the more important job. I don't know. For Coach Osborne to be here in this building is big for the state of Nebraska.
Do you think he ever thought about putting himself in the head coaching position back?
I'm sure he thought about it. He would tell you that Nancy wouldn't have let him coach again. But you know, this was a big decision that he had to make to hire this head coach. And he went with Bo Pelini, and it was a big decision. And Bo Pelini now is head coach. He has to make big decisions like this in big games, and that's why he was hired by Coach Osborne.
Three tight ends. Lawson's the fullback. Castile puts his head down. Penalty flag is thrown, and I think it's probably going to be against Nebraska. And you can see one of the off. It looks like Matt Slauson.
I think
he got up awfully slowly and didn't want to look around very much.
Holding. On that one. Offense, number 70, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Matt Slauson, that's who it was. And you're going to see him pull to the right side, and you're going to see right there, he's got his hand around the jersey, around the neck, rides him to the ground, and that's a killer, Ron. Right there, you have first and goal. Worst case scenario, you get back to the line of scrimmage, you line it up second and goal at the 4. Instead, you're moved all the way back to what, the 14-yard line?
Yeah.
So it's just a much different scenario, and from your senior guard, you don't expect that. Another penalty on Nebraska.
Well, Thomas Lawson stays in at fullback. Hello remains the tailback. Peterson wide to the left. Now they're going to switch receivers, going for two tight ends on the right side. Hello bounces to the outside. Cuts inside. What a move. 5. Touchdown, Nebraska.
What a run by Roy Hello. You can't teach this. This isn't anything in practice that your coach tells you, hey, when this happens, I want you to do this. This is tremendous individual effort. San Jose State had this play sniffed out. Boom, two guys right in front of him. A little sidestep to the outside. Another juke in the open field makes a man miss. A little extra speed to get to the goal line and put the ball into the end zone. A big, big play for Nebraska. And Roy Hello showing you why he is listed as a co-number one running back here in Nebraska.
And the extra point streak remains alive as Henry gets it easily. Evan Newsom had a chance to get Hello, and Hello just had an incredible move there at the 5-yard line. He was the leading rusher last week, and I think it's probably safe to say he's the leading rusher again today by a lot.
9 for 59 yards and a touchdown. You're right, and Marlon Lucky with 5 for 14. So. And Quentin Castile, the other co-number one running back, 6 rushes for 7 yards. So by far and away, it's been Roy Hello who has had the most success in the running game here today.
Well, the Nebraska fans are very happy because at one point it was a 2-point game. Now it's up to a 16-point game. Now, if you're a San Jose State fan, you are not happy because Kyle Reed's been diagnosed with a concussion. And I think you can see by the look on his face, that's probably an accurate diagnosis. He is out for the day.
That's ever a big blow, too. Ever had one of those, Ron? Yeah, you ever had one of those?
Yes, I did. And it's not something I wish on anybody.
No, it's
You hear guys like Zach Thomas, you know, with 5, 6, and 7, and you go, what are you thinking? Get out of the sport.
I don't think players know exactly how many they get. You know? after a couple. One time for sure I had one. You just never know. You get hit upside the head a couple times, you just wonder if you're just out of it a little bit. Did I get a concussion? Yeah. What happened? And you kind of gather yourself and go back out there.
Well, Kanalik doing a nice job. He had one wobbly kickoff. Everything else has been pretty good. Roy Hello, his first career touchdown. Last year didn't have any rushing or receiving. Didn't have one last week. And that got the crowd of 84,000 up. And they got something to cheer about. I mean, it was 14-12 at one point. And it could have been more. Once again, 7 points left on the field by San Jose State. Missed field goals, extra points. Had a penalty which pushed them back. Now Miles Eaton's going to try to do things.
Penalty flag is thrown as Davis is tossed to the turf. Miles Eden, in spring practice, the quarterback for San Jose State, was the number one guy. He's been a backup for the last couple of years.
And he just doesn't bring the dimensions to this offense that Kyle Reed did. Now Nebraska, I think, can really hone in on the running game.
Personal foul, face mask, number 98, 15-yard penalty, first down.
10th penalty against Nebraska in this ball game.
Zach Potter out there on the right side. Somehow must have had illegal hands to the face. But Nebraska now doesn't have to worry so much about Kyle Reed and his legs. You know,
right.
That's the dimension that they're really going to miss. And so they can really lock in on those wide receivers and not have to worry so much about the quarterback taking off.
Because he was just a thrower last week. He was 10 of 13 for 86 yards and an interception. Five wide receivers set. Nebraska being springs three. Eden just throws up a prayer and it's not answered. He wasn't looking where that ball was being thrown because they had a rush on him. Nebraska only rushed three, but Zach Potter was bearing in on him. Watch it. You can't see there. He just turned his head and said, I'm just winging this thing.
And it was a pretty darn good
throw. Jurevich had it.
Jurevich catches that one 8 or 9 out of 10, I would say. With Zach Potter at 6'7", coming at Miles Eden, who's only 6'1".
And that's a SID 6'1".
Yeah, exactly.
That's a Prescott.
5'10" and 3/4".
Yeah. That sets up a second down and 10. This time, pass block knocked away. Fourth block pass. It was intended for Avila. But again, the defensive hands are up for Nebraska.
And you kind of have sensed these last two possessions that Nebraska's come out with more energy on defense. Mm-hmm. They kind of smell blood a little here, and they understand that, you know, the momentum is on their side. They're playing with a lot of enthusiasm. The crowd's back into it. The band is playing. You have a little bit of a lead, and all of a sudden they're blitzing. They're running around. They look like they're playing with a lot more energy right now.
Well, Eric Hags, the one who got the hand on it, his first pass broken up as a Husker. Third down and 10. They drop back. Eden lets it fly, has a man, caught by Jurevich inside the 15, down to the 10. Right on the money. Asante was on the coverage, so Jurevich drops one just moments earlier, pulls this one in.
Big play in this football game. Somehow Nebraska let guys get behind them. And Jurevich just outran Larry Asante.
55 yards, man, on that reception. Now Avila goes wide to the right. First and goal from the 10. Eden keeps it. Ducks his head, maybe gets two on the play. Nice job, Pierre Allen. Sue also in on the stop. But you saw right there, as you mentioned moments ago, Eden does not have the legs that Kyle Reed, who's out with a concussion, has.
Nothing there right out of the gate. So he decides to run it, and could have been a quick face mask there against Nebraska, it looked like.
And there's no involuntary face mask either. That penalty's been gone. Now it's an automatic 15 yards. Five wide receivers, second down and goal from the 8. Eden winds up, intercepted by Zach Potter. The second interception by a D-line today for Nebraska.
How in the world, when you're that close to a guy who's throwing a rocket, are you able to knock it down and catch it? Zach Potter making a big impact on this game. See him come off the left side of the screen, gets those big mitts up.
Well, he threw it
right
in his chest.
Threw it right in his chest, but from that close, I can't tell you how hard that is to catch a ball like that, especially when you're a defensive lineman. What athleticism from a guy that's 6'7", 280 pounds.
Well, unofficially, that's five passes that have been tipped at the line of scrimmage. Two have been intercepted. Gans flares it out, left side, Todd Peterson. Picks up about five on the play. So you think now, Ndamukong Suh, Zach Potter over on the sideline, talking to some of the coaching staff, including Ted Gilmore, saying, you know, we could play a little wide receiver if you need us at 6'7".
Exactly. You know, I watched Zach Potter play basketball in high school, mm-hmm. and had great
All
hands.
State.
Great
State.
Hands for a big man, and really could move well, too. He's put on some weight since he's gotten to Nebraska, but was a big guy in high school as well. You can see the athleticism there. And it's a good thing Eden made that tackle.
Yes, has to dump it off to the safety valve. Thomas Lawson, his first catch of the year. Lawson, who had three receptions last year, all for touchdowns.
Joe Gans had to have great patience here. Lawson sort of fell down. Get back up. Gans was able to wait for him and then find him. You see him fall down right there in the middle of the field. Gans faked the pass, then hit Lawson across the middle.
Third down and short. Well, Sean Watson told us he wanted to get the fullbacks in the game. Lawson getting plenty of playing time today. On third and short, straight ahead running. First down, Nebraska.
And that has
to 40 up to the 42-yard line.
Sorry, Ron, that has to feel good right there. In the fourth quarter,
yep.
In a game like this where you need to run clock, it's third and one, you need to be able to get that yard. There should be no doubt right there as a team. You say, we're going to get this yard. And they push straight ahead, and they got that first down. Now they're able to milk the clock, pretty much put this game away if they don't turn the ball over.
Well, Nebraska led 14-9 at the end of three, also at the end of the first half. And it seemed like San Jose State was closing, made it a two-point game, but then two quick scores here by the Huskers. That's where we are now. Gans keeps it, being chased. Still looking, pass, incomplete. Mike McNeil intended for?
Yeah. Well, I think Mike McNeil thought Gans was going to take off running. And so he started to block, I believe. And Gans likes to get out of the pocket here. This is where you see the baseball player come out of Joe Gans, like a shortstop. Frustrated again because he said, I'm extending the play. I'm giving you an opportunity to work downfield, and I'm going to hit you. You know, I'm going to stay behind the line of scrimmage. And I think Mike McNeil thought he must have been across the line of scrimmage race, so he turned to block.
You never had a quarterback that threw once he left the pocket.
Well, that's what I was going to tell.
Go ahead. You
Crouch
can say
at halftime, you know.
Yeah. Nice pass by Gans. Fingertip catch. Niles Paul inside the 45 to the 43.
How was he able to get that ball through there?
I don't
sidearm. Sidearm pass through the defense, and then a nice catch made by Niles Paul. Look at the angle here that Joe Gans has. He throws kind of a sidearm whipping pass to Niles Paul, who's had a big impact on this game as well.
Niles Paul. It's his first reception of the ball game. That's good for 12 yards. Of course, he has the 85-yard kickoff return. First down. Flip off to the outside. Nice block. Opens a hole for Peterson. Boy, you've got to give credit, though, to Nate Swift on that. And not only did he make the first block, he got up and made another one.
Well, they kind of switched positions here. We had seen Todd Peterson blocking for Nate Swift. Now you have Nate Swift right there with a nice block.
And another
he
one.
Cut two guys, two knockdowns on one play. That's going to make Ted Gilmore happy, the wide receivers coach here in Nebraska.
And you get graded on that, don't you?
Every single play, you're graded on a play. And they record knockdowns for the linemen. They record knockdowns for the wide receivers. You get graded on every play. That's going to be perfect score from Nate Swift.
Gans looking deep. Pass incomplete. Intended for Peterson. Just out of his reach as we go inside of 4.5 to play in the ball game.
Play action fake. A little bootleg to the right side. Joe Gans out of the pocket again. Throwing on the run. Just off the fingertips of Todd Peterson.
Final 4:25, a reminder next week, New Mexico State will be in town, and we will be doing pay-per-view then. Call your local cable subscriber, Husker.com. Kick off 6 o'clock right here at Memorial Stadium. Joe Gans now facing second down and 10 from the 22. They've taken control of this game here in the fourth quarter, and we're going to have a timeout.
Timeout, Nebraska. That's their third and last timeout
And Nebraska, I think that's their final timeout, if I'm not mistaken. They are out of timeouts, which with 4:25 and leading by 16, probably fairly comfortable. So if your coach is right now, you're going to get in the locker room, are they going to say, great game, or are they going to say, gentlemen, we still have some work to do?
They're going to say that. They're going to say that we still have some work to do. And, you know, you enjoy this win because anytime you get a win in college football,
absolutely,
right now you have to take it. You know, there's so many good teams out there. And to get to 8, 9, 10 wins is difficult. So every win, you have to cherish it. You give your guys a little pat on the back for going out and finding a way to get it done. You don't want to be negative right after the game. So you say thanks for the effort today, but we got to get back to work tomorrow.
Well, of course, all was almost lost, though, when this man went out of the ball game, Kyle Reed, because he was having an outstanding game. He was 18 for 26, 161 yards, passing the football, but he was sacked 4 times today. And that's very good news if you're the Nebraska defense, because they had 4 sacks last week, 4 this week, 8 sacks in a ball game. They only had 13 all of last year. Marlon Lucky hasn't seen a lot of playing time back in the lineup. Nope. Hold on, guys. We've got a whistle. You know, you're right about that, the close game, because you look at Ohio State. There are many people around this country picking them to play for the national championship.
False start, 72, offense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
You don't think Ohio State could have been looking forward to next weekend, do
you?
Well,
yeah, against USC, obviously. But, you know, they only went probably by 12. I'm not sure the exact final score, but they were only up by 12. It happens.
No, and even though you're at home, Nebraska's still, in some positions, a young football team,
mm-hmm,
with a new staff. And so you get a win here today, and you feel good about it for a little bit, and you come back and you go to work tomorrow and get better.
Little shuttle pass to Lucky. Looks for some running room inside the 20, down to the 18-yard line.
It's going to be a holding penalty,
I believe. Too.
Holding, offense, number 67. Be a 10-yard penalty.
12 penalties in this ballgame. Ouch.
The center, Jacob Hickman. And, you know, Nebraska has officials at every practice.
Right.
You know, a lot of teams do, but Nebraska has officials there every day, and they want them to be watching for these sorts of things,
mm-hmm. So
you don't get sloppy in practice, and then you can't make the adjustment in a game. But time and time again, we've seen penalties today, and that's definitely going to be something that's going to have to be addressed.
Well, that sets up a second down and 25. That didn't work. Iannaccio on the coverage. If you can call it that.
That didn't work. They try to run that screen. Now you're in a third and extremely long. I mean, look, the game isn't exactly over right now.
I've seen stranger things
happen.
Two
touchdowns and 2 2-point conversions. Now Nebraska's out of field goal range. They don't get anything here. They're going to have to probably punt and give it back to San Jose State.
Yep.
Yeah, crazier things have happened for sure. Like you said, don't get sloppy here down the stretch.
And here we go. Third down and a bundle. Again, straight drop, has some time, looks the deep out, pass caught at the 20-yard line. Peterson still on his feet, will be short of the first down, but at least he gets down to about the 16-yard line. Todd Peterson on the reception, his 4th of the afternoon.
Patience from Joe Gans. Sort of a stop route for Peterson on the outside. And a nice gainer that gets Nebraska down in field goal range. It looks like they're going to go for it.
Fourth down and 4. First time today they've gone for it on fourth down. First time this year they've gone for it on fourth down. They need 4. Here comes some pressure. Gans running away from it, looking, has a man across the field. Penalty flag, new life for Nebraska.
Francis was on the coverage against Todd Peterson. He saw it coming. Peterson was running a little drag route across the goal line. Francis tried to come underneath the play and knock it away, and they got him for that hand around the back of Todd Peterson.
And they'll talk about it, but the bottom line is it's new life for the Huskers.
And that's going to pretty much
seal it.
Pass interference. Defense, number 21. The ball will be placed on the 2-yard line. First down.
Yeah, Francis had him.
it's hard to see that left arm. Couldn't really see if he was grabbing onto Peterson or not. Bo Pelini can breathe a little easier here. First and goal.
First and goal, Nebraska with the 2 yard line.
And it's on the 2 yard line. Lucky alone in the backfield. 3:08 to play in this contest. The pitch to Lucky. He's got a convoy in front of him. He'll walk into pay dirt. Lucky with a touchdown.
Good job from the offensive line. Marlon Lucky using that speed to get to the edge. A little toss sweep. And this is one where you say, use that speed to get to the edge. Mike McNeil with a nice block. See Mike Smith out in front. Todd Peterson's out there blocking. And now Nebraska can make it 35-12. And it doesn't look like such a close game.
No.
But it sure was.
It was 14-12 at one point. And the extra point streak continues. Marlon Lucky's third touchdown of the year, second touchdown rushing for the year. Takes it in from a couple of yards out with 3:03 to play. The Huskers now lead it 35-12. Speaking of that Ohio State game, it was a 12-point win by Ohio State, by the way.
Good effort, though, from
Ohio U.
Go in there. That's going to be a battle. Some good games next weekend.
There are a lot of good games. USC, Ohio State, obviously the big one. And the way Ohio State played against Virginia, Matt Sanchez, outstanding. Ray Maluga, the linebacker, who I think is the best linebacker in the country. Oh, no disrespect to Laurinaitis from Ohio State. But you throw Brian Cushing in there, who was at the Pac-10 meetings this year. I thought he was a defensive lineman. They've got the best linebackers I've seen in a long time, just as a team.
Tremendous athleticism.
And I think they've got a lot of potential stars on that team also. On USC. So it's going to be a good game.
I don't know if most people think they may not lose this year. So.
Yeah, well, Joe McKnight's pretty stout.
They're so deep.
That's the thing.
And what shocks me every year is how they're able to plug in young guys.
Oh, yeah.
Even as talented as they are, they still have freshmen that come in and play right away.
That's right. That's one of Pete Carroll's philosophies, though. You know, we got to get these kids in. If you think they're ready, let's do it. Adi, one of the few ones return. This is Rutley. Straight up the middle. Over the 35 to the 38-yard line. That'll be about a 35-yard return, and that gives the special teams coaches something to talk about tomorrow.
Another kickoff return past the 35-yard line.
Here's the way things shook out today. 14-6 was the score at the end of one. Of course, San Jose State went up early 6-0. And then it was 14-9 at the end of two and at the end of three. They cut it to 19-12. Or 14-12, I should say, and then Nebraska went on a big roll, and that's where we are right now. Yeah, 35-12 with 2:57 to play in the contest.
Really, it was that kickoff return by Niles Paul that just changed this game completely.
Leah Ina is now in the backfield. Leah Ina has it. Freshman out of Oxnard, California. 10 days before the first game of the year, Leah Ina was a linebacker. Now he's playing running back, and he's the only ukulele playing high back in college football. Just
wow.
A little tidbit for you there.
There you go.
Kind of a Jason Castro American Idol thing working.
There you go.
Yeah.
I will remember that one for future use. How do you come up with some of this stuff, man?
I don't know what the shoes are, though. They were just giving me in my ear, giving me grief. I don't know what the people holding the shoes up, but I know that this kid who lives 1,500 miles away can play the ukulele. So I don't know.
Well, good for him. He's a big, strong kid.
Yeah, now Pierre Allen looks like he's not moving too well right there. Starters played a lot of minutes.
They did. A lot of downs. And Nebraska found a way to pull away with this one. San Jose State played well all day today. You always talk about games like this, Ron. Five or six plays usually change a game one way or another, and they change the entire scope of the game.
Eden winds up, throws, pass off the fingertips of Brian Ellidge.
And today was the exact same thing.
Right.
The Sue interception, the Potter interception, the Niles Paul kick return.
That's right.
The missed opportunities in the kicking game for San Jose State. Just a handful of plays in the middle of a game that has 140, 150 plays are what really decides a football game. Nebraska was on the right end of those plays today.
A lot of coaching points available, needless to say. Niles Paul's already got an 85-yard touchdown return on the kickoff. He is standing back at his own 20-yard line. Almost blocked. Paul will get a chance. Sidesteps one. Outside, gets another block. Tiptoeing down the sideline, finally steps out of bounds. The wall started to form.
And that might take a little bit. The San Jose State player, didn't see what it was. He got popped on the sidelines. Number 14, bam.
Now,
Will Henry, after almost blocking the punt, comes around on the wall on the sidelines, delivers a knockout blow.
Travis Jones is a little wobbly. He's fine on the sideline. They already lost their quarterback, Kyle Reed, to a concussion. Well, Joe Gans is going to sit down, and Patrick Witt comes in, the redshirt freshman out of Wiley, Texas. Senior year of high school, threw for over 1,800 yards. There's the running game going as they go to some of the reserves in their camp. Marcus Mendoza, this is a young man they're very high on. A redshirt freshman out of Houston, Texas, Spring Woods High School. Coaches were telling us this kid's got some zip.
He does. He's really quick. And his future in Nebraska is very bright. He just happens to have three running backs in front of him that are
right.
Pretty good. He wouldn't be fourth string at very many schools in the country. Little scat back.
Patrick Witt in a close battle for that backup quarterback spot with Zach Lee, the sophomore out of San Francisco. This time, San Jose State defense stacks him up. So it looks like Nebraska will be outgained in this ball game, barring something unforeseen. 353 to 303. So the string of 300-yard passing games by Joe Gans comes to an end. Four straight, four touchdown passing games also for Gans. That streak stops, but it has to stop sometime.
That's right. And, you know, this offense didn't move the ball as well as they wanted to today, obviously.
Right.
But, you know, we talked about it. They found a way to get it done today.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you do as a football team. It really brings you together. Everybody understands their role is vital.
Three-step drop. That should be an incomplete pass. His hand was moving forward. Final 12 seconds of the ball game. Negos, the redshirt freshman from San Jose, California, is the one who got to him. And, you know, Bo Pelini, you know, I always ask coaches, have you had time to enjoy things? Carl Pelini said to us yesterday, you know, maybe I should take time. I think Bo's thinking the same thing right now. He's going to say great win. I agree with you, but his brain's probably going 100 miles an hour now.
Well,
what he needs to work on.
Post-game press conference, you know, he's going to be short, and he's not going to be extremely happy. He's going to be like, hey, you know, we got to win, but
yep.
A lot we need to work on. Our guys know it.
Little shuttle pass to Marcus Mendoza, nothing doing. That should be the final play of the ball game. So it was a dogfight for the Cornhuskers, but Bo Pelini goes to 2-0 this season as the head coach. And that's the important number you're worrying about, not about offensive numbers. Matt, Joel, and I'll be back to wrap things up right after this. But Nebraska wins at the final again, 35-12.
Here at Memorial Stadium, joined by Coach Pelini right now. And, Coach, talk about the difference in that first half and finally getting things going in the second half.
Well, we fixed some of our, we were really sloppy in the first half. And, really, we continue to be somewhat sloppy in the second half. And we weren't at our best, and there's a lot of things to fix. I'm happy we got a win, and I give credit to San Jose State. They played hard, and which didn't surprise me. Dick, Coach Tomey, a team that he coaches, I know they're going to play hard, and they're going to play aggressive and physical. But we got a lot of work to do, and we go back to work on Monday.
Was there a difference, a turning point, whether it be the Niles Paul kickoff return or what?
Well, obviously, that gave us a little jolt right there, to step it up and to make a play. And so he made a play, and it kind of kick-started us there. And but we got a win, but we got a lot of work to do. But I'm happy to get the win and just go back to work tomorrow.
All right, congratulations on the win.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, that is Coach Bo Pelini saying quite a bit, I think, of what Matt was predicting. And actually, before we go back upstairs, guys, we've Got a special guest as well, as we are joined right now by Niles Paul. We were just talking about the big kickoff return. Congratulations, first off, on the win. What did you see on the kickoff return? Take us through that play.
We seen that they was cheating outside on our right side, so coach wanted me just to hit up the seam on the left side because he's kicking it to the left side. So I hit it. I had a great block by Fonzo and Thomas Lawson, and I just ran as hard as I could to the end zone.
I know that there's nothing that a return man likes better than taking it to the house. What are the emotions like at that point, and what do you think it did to the team as far as the way you guys were playing?
I definitely think it motivated the team. I mean, I wanted to be that difference maker for the team, and I helped out. And my played my part, but it was a team effort. We all went out there and played hard. Everybody played hard today.
Congratulations on the win.
Thank you.
All right, so Nebraska victorious, and you hear from a couple of the victorious people involved, Coach Pelini and Niles Paul. Let's go back upstairs to you guys.
For Coach Pelini, you could see it is just the way his body language was. Yes, I'm happy with a win. But he even said that after last week, and he told us yesterday that this team's got a lot of work to do. He knows that you don't become a great football team overnight.
No, that's right. And you have a young team, you have a brand new staff, and it's going to take some time. You're going to have some growing pains. I think the most disappointing thing he's going to see today is that week one to week two, I don't know that the improvement was there.
Right.
And sometimes you can put up with errors on the field, physical errors, where you're trying to go make a play. It was the mental errors that I think today he's going to really look back on. It's going to bother a head coach. The 12 penalties, the turnovers, those are what's really going to bother him. But they'll go back and work on those things. The good thing is you got out of here with a win, and Nebraska's 2-0.
Did you feel the team came out a little flat maybe in the first quarter of the ballgame?
You know, you never know how a team's going to react early in the morning. You know, last week was a night game. You come out, it's an 11:30 in the morning game, and it was a different routine. For the young guys especially, they haven't played in the morning before. You roll out of bed, it's a little bit different. I think the crowd was a little bit flat. And, yeah, the team might have come out with a little less intensity than we saw a week ago.
Well, the bottom line is Nebraska wins. Next week, of course, New Mexico State. Kickoff set for 6 o'clock. That will also be pay-per-view. So go to Huskers.com or call your local cable provider. We want to have you there for that. Once again, Nebraska wins it. Final score, 35-12. Today's Nebraska-San Jose State game is an exclusive presentation of FSN pay-per-view. Our next